important for us to remember our history. You know, unless you're one of the first Americans, a Native American, you came from someplace else. Somebody brought you.
We trade that reservation, the value of that reservation, and the value of its people, the value of its air, the value of its carbon emissions, are traded on Wall Street. Dun & Bradstreet through Dun & Bradstreet. It's listed. So we haven't even hit on all the swindles that Wall Street is visiting upon the people of America. You're nothing but a bunch of coupons for the United States government and the people who run it. That's it. American people, you're a commodity, and you don't deserve anything else. And they're going to make sure you continue to be a commodity as long as the empire exists. As long as you allow the Constitution to be raped.
As the flood of illegals surges over the southern border, President Obama is going for broke, literally. CNS News reports that since the budget deal was signed in November of 2015, in just 6 months, Obama has added another trillion to our national debt, bringing it to a monstrous $19 trillion. While more taxpayer money is thrown at the Immigration and Customs Enforcement deportation budget, deportations themselves have decreased by nearly 43%. Breitbart reports, according to a recent chart from the Senate Subcommittee on Immigration and National Interest, ICE removed nearly 43% fewer total aliens from the United States in the fiscal year of 2015 than it did in the fiscal year of 2012, and nearly 62% fewer aliens from the interior of the United States. Ironically, as the number of deportations the Obama administration carried out tumbled, its budget for removals and detention continued to grow from $2,750,843,000 in fiscal year 2012 to $3,431,444,000 in fiscal year 2015. But the most alarming statistic from Breitbart's report is that ICE removed 235,390 criminal aliens from the United States in fiscal year 2012, as compared with 139,368 in fiscal year 2015, meaning that it deported nearly 41% fewer criminal aliens last year, with 25% more resources than it had in fiscal year 2012. As illegal immigrant crimes in the U.S. go largely unreported, even mentioning the unwarranted murders of American citizens by illegal immigrants is deemed racist by New World Order brainwashed dupes. And if you think the perpetual raping going on by ungrateful Islamic hordes is only occurring in Europe, think again.
New documents say the man accused of kidnapping and sexually assaulting a gas station worker uttered Allah Akbar during the assault.
Four illegal aliens from Guatemala are charged in the rape of a Massachusetts woman and the vicious beating of her boyfriend. And one of the suspects was arrested less than a month before the attack. The quartet has been saddled with a slew of charges. It's been 2 years since Fusion reported that a staggering 80% of Central American girls and women crossing Mexico en route to the United States are raped along the way. Meanwhile, Panama announced they are transferring 3,000 U.S.-bound Cuban migrants to Mexico as Cuban migration spikes. And in 2016, immigrant families crossing the border is 40% higher than the previous record in 2014. When the history books are written, the flood of a great unknown and unchecked exodus of chaos in the face of all reason, civility, and legality revolving around the enforcement of immigration laws that have dictated the policy for immigration for centuries will go down as one of the most reckless acts instigated by a U.S. president in modern history.
But every time you try to get away from the government, they'll kill you. I put you in prison. Or let you become an American. If you catch my drift. Because you're the new Indian. You're the new American Indian. Congratulations. Welcome to the club.
John Bound for Infowars.com.
It had not been announced until about an hour ago. On this Thursday, May 5th, 2016, officially at the Donald Trump website, Donald J. Trump for President. We're going to link to this in our story that is red-linked, or should be, up on Infowars.com. I pledge to you that we're going to keep Donald Trump honest or die trying, metaphorically. But things are complex. Trump needs watchdogs in what he's doing. When he came out and said, hey, you know, they're murdering Christians. We got to bring them here from Syria. Our own government tried to overthrow Syria. Obama was horrible to do it, but now they're murdering hundreds of thousands of Christians. We got to bring them here. And then when he found out it was jihadis they were bringing in, unvetted, he went, whoa, until we vet these people, stop them all. So he went from a radical Muslim coddler to someone that hates all Muslims in the media spin machine. But when Trump got criticized on that and appraised the info, he said, whoa, I didn't know we were bringing unvetted people. Shut it down until they're checking it. That's common sense. It's like there's a gas leak in your house, and until you find it, you go out to the side of the house, you turn it off. Or if there's a broken pipe in your house, you go out to the front of the house, to the water main, you open up the little manhole, and you turn it off. Japan doesn't let any Muslims immigrate there, period. They have the lowest crime rate, by the way, in much of the world. That's because their government has deemed that it's incompatible with their culture. I don't think all Muslims are bad or out to get everybody, but at the same time, when they're jihadis and they're saying they're going to come here and make us go under their rule and their law and want to conquer us, and that's the whole attitude, absolutely not. But see, that's how the spin machine works. I'm digressing, though, on a rabbit trail of my example of many times when Trump finds out he's wrong about something, he will then come out and say, I was wrong, and explain why he did it. Hillary, along with Obama, for about 10 years, has been saying they want to shut down all coal power plants. And then, of course, that means shut down coal mines, both surface lignite and also deep mines like they have in Kentucky and West Virginia. She came out, of course, last year and again this year, just a month ago, and said on the campaign trail, we're going to bankrupt coal. We're going to shut down the coal miners. Obama has said we're going to bankrupt coal. You can build a coal power plant, but we will bankrupt you. She now says she means that that meant to save everyone. So see, that's a total twisted lie, flip-flop. When Trump is wrong about something, he goes, I was wrong. When I got more info, I changed my mind. That's the opposite. That's doing the right thing. That's not a flip-flop. So I have talked about the way these campaign works and that most people in the power structure are establishment. Most people in the power structure are attached to Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, and or the Council on Foreign Relations, or both. And so Trump's going to have problems being able to run a campaign against Hillary without getting some insiders. That's why I wasn't against him meeting with Richard Haass, the head of the CFR, a month ago. But I said, watch if Trump changes his foreign policy statements, and watch if Haass says he likes him. Haass came out a week later and said Trump is horrible. He's the worst possible choice ever, and you notice Trump's gotten more nationalistic in his speeches. That said, our story isn't exclusive. It's up on Infowars.com. I talked to multiple people in and around the Trump campaign at the highest levels. I've talked to Roger Stone, who has even delayed his trip to New York today to research this, but he is researching right now, and we'll be popping in today or tomorrow to give his take on it, but I have other sources as well that first alerted to me to this last night, and then this morning. And then Paul Watson had finished his report. Will you guys bring me the Trump press release again? I know you brought it to me, but I've moved it around in my stack and I can't find it. Thank you. Just bring it to me again. Thank you. Oh, here it is. It's on the back. It was stuck inside here. Teleprompter free, folks. This is unscripted. We actually operate with our intellects and history and understanding and our will and our love of truth. And so Paul Watson and I began researching this, and this was nowhere. But on one site that had noticed that this guy's name had been mentioned in the Wall Street Journal yesterday in the headlined article, Donald Trump won't self-fund general election campaign. Presumptive Republican nominee plans to create world-class finance organization to back campaign. And then he sent out Corey Lewandowski and others. This is outside of Paul Manford and Roger Stone. I know that. They're not involved in this. They can't speak to it yet, but they weren't aware of this. And we went and checked the Trump website early this morning. Nothing about this guy's name. No statements. Nowhere. Boom. As I went live on air, Roger Stone sent me an email saying, it's official. He's going to find out who put it out. Donald J. Trump announces national finance chairman. Steve Mnuchin, M-N-U-C-H-N. Stephen M-U, that's really hard to pronounce. That give anybody with dyslexia a headache. Stephen Mnuchin, M-N-U-C-H-I-N, to serve critical role as Trump campaign gears up for general election. To be the head finance chair to run the gathering of donations, both small and large. And what Trump has always said is he's not going to take lobbyist money. He's not going to take big PAC money. And he's the only person I've ever seen in modern history who ran the last 16-month campaign without big corporate money and without PACs. Now, his lawyers have gone after PACs that have been set up by Jesse Benton and others, claiming that they're working for Trump when they're not. And that's official. From the Trump campaign. Not attacking Jesse Benton, former head of the Ron Paul campaign. It's just the reality. But Stone is running unofficial PACs that just promote open elections and voter rights. And that's why I've been supportive of those moves on air, as the listeners have, and the integrity of our election system in this country under the Bill of Rights, the Constitution. But this new development is very, very troubling. And we have an article detailing it all from the inside sources, the best we know. Exclusive. Koch Soros insiders attempt to take over Trump campaign. Establishment in last-ditch effort to co-opt New York billionaire. A major effort is underway to co-opt the Donald Trump campaign by infiltrating it with Koch brothers, George Soros-like operatives. Inside sources have exclusively told Infowars.com. Yesterday, it was revealed that Stephen Mnuchin would become the Trump campaign's national finance chair. Mnuchin was an investment professional with Soros Fund Management, LLC, and spent 17 years at Goldman Sachs, so he's a Spectre alumni. He also has innumerable other affiliations with establishment financial institutions and corporations. However, the appointment was engineered by Trump campaign manager Corey Lewandowski, it appears. I mean, that's who reportedly is making these decisions, who himself has close ties with and has worked for the Koch brothers, having overseen the New Hampshire chapter of the Americans for Prosperity. And they've come out and said they'd rather have Hillary than Trump. The advocacy group, founded by Koch brothers, although Lewandowski is not directly responsible for the infiltration, he is being used as a dupe by Mnuchin and others as part of a move to either take control of the Trump campaign or contrive a media narrative that Trump has sold out to the establishment. And I'll be quite honest with you. If Trump comes out and uses big establishment financial organizers, it's pretty much all you can do sometime. If he's making the shots and calling the shots and he thinks he can control these people, you know, that's just how it works. I mean, it's pretty clear that American Airlines was working with the globalists to cover up what really happened on 9/11. I still get on American Airlines aircraft because the pilots, the flight crew, the people in the control towers, you know, are good people. The flight attendants are good people. The stewardesses, to be politically incorrect. It's criminal executives at the top that are compromised. So this is still a dangerous direction to be going in, because Trump has done so well not hiring any of these people. We've seen Hillary and Ted Cruz being excoriated by the media, the alternative media, by the people, and really being discredited for their close alliances with the corrupter elements of Wall Street, the globalist elements, the crony elements, the banker bailout elements, the anti-gun Goldman Sachs elements, the Soros elements. And so I have an issue with this. And the article goes on to break it all down. Trump campaign, it goes on, or contrive a media narrative that Trump has sold out to the establishment. A sign that Trump is, well, it just goes on from there. I'm going to be breaking more of this down when we come back from break. Guys, I think I'm missing a page of this article. This has kind of been the day of that. Now, continuing, ladies and gentlemen, we have the press release right here. This is not really the top story of the day. I just wanted to go ahead and get it out of the way up front and continue to move forward and also give you our pledge to analyze every facet of the Trump campaign and vet what's real and what's not. You know, last week it was that he's basically having sex with underage girls or something with no evidence. And, of course, that turned out to be a giant hoax, and we said it was a hoax. And they've got all these other hoaxes they're pushing against Trump. But we will dig into every single one of them. Stay with us. All right, so the story with all the inside baseball and details is up on Infowars.com. Exclusive. Koch Soros insiders attempt to take over the Trump campaign. Establishment is in last-ditch effort to co-opt the New York billionaire. We'll see how Trump responds to this. Quite frankly, it's hard to be involved in a major national campaign and not have some of these people in there. If he ever starts changing his policies or he ever stops his pledge to repeal Obamacare or to try to control our borders, I will turn on him like 50-day-old milk, I mean, instantly. But we are watching this closely, and we've seen some other troubling things out of Lewandowski before. And the question is he trying to co-opt the campaign? Well, regardless, it's happening. Is he behind it? Is he the one that's made a lot of the big missteps? Absolutely. And I don't have it out for Lewandowski, but I remember during the Ron Paul campaigns, Jesse Benton just always came up with causing the problems in two different campaigns. And I would hold my tongue. And then years later, everybody turned against him and all the stuff came out. And then it's him again running this big supposed Trump pack that isn't a Trump pack. And they won't stop doing it when Trump asks them to stop doing it. So really what I'm getting at is there's all these forces that try to get into a campaign at this high level. I mean, if you've got a successful restaurant, people are going to try to get a job there and do weird stuff inside of it. Or if you have a business, I mean, everybody's experienced this. If you're in the media and you're very successful, there's always people trying to weasel in. So when I'm covering this, it's not to go, hey, let's make hay out of a Goldman Sachs, Soros connected people, Koch brother connected, got the trifecta going on here. Let's just point it out and let's watch it. And let's ask the larger question. Trump said he wasn't going to take big corporate money and he wasn't going to take big lobbyist money. Now, the media is going to be able to spin this, that he's going into the general election trying to raise money now and not self-financing, as if he's going back on a promise. No, he said he would try to mainly self-finance, selling baseball hats and shirts and using his own money. But Hillary's got $1 billion left to spend. So obviously he's going to have to get some organizations and groups to donate. And I don't see that as going back on a promise. But if he starts taking globalist money, then we're going to have a big problem. And so this is all part of keeping people honest. That's what we're doing. Now, I do not want to get into this anymore because this is not near our top story today. It is an exclusive to Infowars.com. But our integrity will continue on no matter what. It's just like Ted Cruz. He had a good voting record in the Senate. He had a really bad pedigree, really bad connections to nasty globalists. And he uncloaked about 6 months ago and really showed us who he was. And now I'm very, very sad that I was ever supportive of Ted Cruz. Quite frankly, a year ago, I was supporting him overall over Donald Trump. But I liked the nationalist bent of Donald Trump. And now, you know, we have New Yorker magazine saying Ted Cruz's Goldman Sachs problem. And so Trump has got his people bringing in Goldman Sachs people and Soros-connected people to run his finance system. My biggest issue, I guess, is the optics of that. If Trump's going to criticize Cruz for that and Hillary, then what's he thinking? And the word is Trump does not know and did not know. And there were scrabbling phone calls last night and this morning over this. And it came down to Lewandowski. But then no one wants to actually burn him. So there's an investigation. And while the investigation's going on this morning, an hour ago, this press release shoots out. And if you just tuned in and you're saying, okay, then what is it, Alex? Is it a big deal or isn't it? I war game openly. I wear my brain on my sleeve. Quite frankly, I don't know what's going on. It smells. I don't like it. I have a nauseous feeling. Okay? And not that Trump's betraying anybody. It's just that these people are everywhere. They run the system. And you've got so many of these campaign managers who'll make deals with the system, like Jesse Benton and the Senate Majority Leader from Kentucky having deals when he supposedly has been working for Senator Paul. And now see where Senator Paul is being betrayed by the Republican Party. So these campaign managers, 9 times out of 10, are double-minded in my view. And I'm going to just stop right there. But we need to see what Trump does now with the optics of this. Because he definitely doesn't want to start taking Goldman Sachs money. It's one thing if you hire somebody that's been Soros connected. Soros knows how to run campaigns. And Goldman Sachs. That starts ringing alarm bells. But if you take Goldman Sachs money, I think I'm going to have a heart attack. All right. We'll open phones later. You can give me your view on this. It's a complex issue, obviously. But I'm going to get into Hillary. Boy, you talk about lying with the coal miners and more. We're going to play these clips coming up. Some of the great things Trump's been saying about Obamacare and the open borders and a lot more. He's been doubling down there. That's very encouraging. I don't just half-bake my political views, my geopolitical views, my cultural views. I really try to research. That's why when I spent a few hours with Paul Watson working on this exclusive story at Infowars.com, Koch, Soros, insiders attempt to take over Trump campaign from within, I basically got up here on air the first 30 minutes and just war-gamed in my mind because I was so busy just putting the facts down in the article that afterwards I was trying to come to my conclusion on air as to what I thought about it. And I think despite all of my inherent and incoherent babbling sometimes, that's why this broadcast is so popular, because it inherently is real and is totally honest down to my guts. Now, going over the news, it's all just over the top. I somehow have to cover all of this today. We also have two really informative guests. James O'Keefe with the Veritas Project has had some new amazing coups. ProjectVeritas.com. Wayne Madsen was on yesterday for 10 minutes. He's on for a full hour today to break down all the big developments in campaign 2016, that he continues to be one of the main investigative journalists with more big breaking stories nationwide than pretty much anybody else. We're very proud that he works as a correspondent for Infowars.com. So he's going to be joining us. We'll also have open phones as well after James O'Keefe leaves us. And then into the Wayne Madsen interview, Rob Doom, InfoWars news director, will be honchoing the fourth hour today on this Thursday transmission. Good old 5-5, May 5th, 2016. I want to get into the Trump situation where he says total disaster, repeal Obamacare again, not backing off on that. Wonderful. Also continuing to say again and again that we should not have the disaster that Europe's had flooding this country with massive Muslim immigration from the most radical countries in the world. But there's a whole bunch of clips. I guess there's 5 of them dealing with Hillary and the coal miners. And coal mining is what built the British Empire in its last 100 years. It's what funded and powered the Industrial Revolution. It's what drove our Industrial Revolution. And it's now the cleanest burning fuel there is with technology. The cheapest form as well. And I harp on this constantly. I have no coal stocks, no energy stocks, not involved in it. I just know my power bill has more than doubled the last 8 years because they've shut down more than 1,000 coal power plants. And it's a big deal. And it's a bigger deal when she comes out and says, we're going to bankrupt coal, we're going to shut down the coal miners, just like Obama said to audiences that support that get off on shutting the country down. The post-industrial, nihilistic, transhumanist eugenicist. They love China having all the plants they want, or Mexico. They just don't want us to. It's a sick cult of control freaks. You know, the folks that want you to have a 200-square-foot coffin apartment. These are very bad people. Then she comes out and says, well, what I meant by that was it's inevitable unless we save them. No, you're the person running the program to destroy them. And you know who set all this up in the 80s with Al Gore was Enron. They're an oil company. They don't like to compete against cheap energy, do they? Just like Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan and BP and British Petroleum, just search engine it. They're all the top funders. They're all in the top 10 funders of shutting down coal power plants. And again, they always point video cameras at power plants in the winter when hot water vapor and CO2 are coming out. And they go, look at the smoke. Look at the pollution. That's not pollution. That's like when you breathe and you see what looks like smoke, that's water vapor. And I know that our listeners know that, but let me tell you who don't know. The general public actually thinks that's smoke. Now, in China and Mexico, it is smoke. That's why it goes on for 5 miles and then dissipates as it gets aerosolized, but it's still there. It just gets diluted. European and U.S. coal power plants, the smoke is not smoke. It's water vapor and carbon dioxide. It ends at about 100 yards. Just like any other washer or dryer on the side of your house in the winter. Notice you only see that in the winter because it's hot, moist air blowing out. You don't see that in the summer. You look at Mexico City or you look at Calcutta or you look at Beijing or Peking, they're living hellholes with the smog because their governments don't want to be outcompeted. So they have no environmental standards. I think we should all have standards and do something about it, but instead only we have the standards. So I'm digressing, but this is so fundamental to understand artificial scarcity, globalism, and how they operate. We're going to get to that in a moment. I also want to add that we were able to extend this through Sunday, but it will end then. I was able to extend it basically a week. And we have the very best high-quality storable foods you're going to find out there the last 25 years. Produced by My Patriot Supply. It's called InfoWars Select. It's the exact same food, just 30 to 40% off. I'm able to give you that discount only a few times a year. That's why I'm trying to extend it this time. We normally are about 10% lower than My Patriot, the exact same full spectrum, exact same meals. In fact, you can buy My Patriot Supply and their full catalog at InfoWarsStore.com and support the broadcast. And they already have a great deal, but you have the exact same food, 30 to 40% off. It will be ending soon. And don't worry, next week it'll still be about 10% less. And we'll have some other specials as well. Just nothing like this. And with the buildup for global riots and the buildup for global war and all the crazy stuff and earth changes going on and the increased earthquakes and the ring of fire and the volcanoes getting active all over the U.S., I hope I don't need my storable food. But I'll tell you this, I've been getting more for the office, more for my home, medical supplies, getting my firearms in place, getting my security plan in place, because civilization is teetering. And all over the world, it's been collapsing into road warrior-like scenarios in the Middle East and Africa and areas of Asia and areas of Eastern Europe. It's getting really bad. Civilization is unraveling. And now is the time to get prepared. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free. We can tell you about all the different specials when you call or different discounts. The mega sale is going to end Sunday evening. At midnight, it's over. I promise. It ends then because I've signed a deal that I can't go any further. 30, 40% off InfoWars Select storable food. People need to take action today, obviously, and 10% off all other preparedness items, non-GMO, super high-quality heirloom seeds, all the nutraceuticals from Survival Shield Nation99X2 to DNA Force to Anthroplex to Brain Force to Lung Cleanse to Colloidal Silver, Silver Bullet to G-Shock Watches, the water filtration systems, shortwave radios, TheraSafe for when reactors meltdown, privacy and security with the Block It Pocket systems and others, So you drive around with your cell phone. It's not being tracked, not being hacked. Pull it out of the little package when you want to use it, then reconnects. One way to control Big Brother, strategic relocation, the books, strategic relocation, the film, all of it 10% off. Infowarsstore.com. And your purchase makes everything we do here possible. Finally, you can also get free shipping on everything at Infowarsstore.com and InfowarsLife.com when you get $50 or more on your order. And there's free shipping, obviously, on some things that we're running specials on all the time, just period. There's just a lot of different specials. And on top of all of that, we also have 10% off with folks that sign up for auto ship. So a lot of different specials at InfowarsStore.com or InfowarsLife.com. Anthroplex is now back in stock. Supernova Vitality did sell out. Ultra powerful vitamin B12 Secret 12 is back in stock. And so much more at InfowarsStore.com or InfowarsLife.com. Again, to find the specific nutraceuticals, InfowarsSelect.com takes you right to our storable foods and preparedness section. 30 to 40% off, and it ends in 3 days. And that is it. It will not be extended anymore. And your purchase makes what we're doing possible. So I thank you all for your support. Again, why are they shutting down the power plants? To move the jobs to globalist industrial bases where the top controllers have moved production the last 50 years. They're accelerating what's left now with their environmental regulations and taxes and controls. We have the highest corporate taxes in the world, in the United States, lobbied for by the big corporations to force even smaller corporations to move offshore to complete our deindustrialization. Then they write in the provisos that they can be tax exempt offshore. That's how the screw job works. Why would you want to compete when you could just rig the deal with the communist Chinese, with the post-imperial Indians, and the folks in Mexico who've never really gotten out from under colonialism? Before I get to the coal debacle, I want to cover this. I get tweets, I get asked questions, I get emails saying, what do you think of Cinco de Mayo? And I say, I think it's great. I'm all about overthrowing the Spanish, or all about overthrowing the French, which is this particular holiday. And it's the most important holiday in Mexico. Cinco de Mayo is Spanish for May 5th. It's a celebration held on May 5th. The date is observed to commemorate the Mexican Army's unlikely victory over French forces at the Battle of Puebla, if I pronounced that correctly, on May 5th, 1862. Now, let's just stop right there. That said, in the United States, Cinco de Mayo has become a Mecha La Raza holiday for many gang member type folks who then try to go around with the Ford Foundation and the media and the globalist-controlled press and bully Hispanics to say, you're not American, or you're not whatever your identity is. You're not a Venezuelan. You're not a Chilean. You're not, because those folks I've talked to get bullied. You're a Mexican. And it turns into this weird nationalist thing where they burn American flags. I videotaped it in downtown Austin at the Capitol and run around holding babies up going, Mexico, Mexico, La Raza, La Raza, race, race, race. I find the Ku Klux Klan running around doing that to be very, very untasteful, and I've protested them. But when you go out and cover the mainly Mexican nationals, it's their holiday, running around saying Texas belongs to Mexico. No, you couldn't take it from the Comanches, so you brought in the Tennesseans and Alabamans, who were in giant Indian wars, as they were called, said to have a big death battle. And yes, the people in the South were pretty much psychotic and enjoyed giant battles. And defending their families and just all this insane. And the Indians loved it too. I'm going to use the word Indians because everybody says use the word Native American. I mean, the point was is that it was just two groups that just loved fighting and loved killing each other. And quite frankly, it's not that the Mexicans wouldn't fight. They just, their people wouldn't colonize it. They didn't want to be up here. They didn't like the Indian raids. That's a historical fact. So the Mexican government, when it was the Spanish government, came and told Tennesseans and Alabamans and others, they said, we're going to give you huge pieces of land, basically free. You got to convert to Catholicism, and you can bring your guns in, and we want you to wipe out the natives. So because they hadn't been able to do it. And the Spanish facilities, the Spanish missions that were really military operations, and the Jesuit systems, they were unable to get the Plains Indians to convert. They got everybody else to do it and move into the reservation and become agrarian. It did not work well with the Comanches, the Apaches, and some of the other groups, the Blackfoot and others. They just never got their mission set up, you notice, in the Midwest and in Texas, except right around the border areas, because they all got slaughtered. So that's the big dirty secret. The Spanish brought in a bunch of rewilded cavemen from Europe. So that's what happened. You know, you took the civilized people of Europe who were really under imperial conditioning and slavery. They turned them loose here. Then one generation, they were completely psychotic and ran around murdering everybody, but also building things and you know, and taking over. And then the natives were always trying to hire them to kill the other group, but it just didn't work out. And that's what really happened. So they lost the conquest. Anyway, so I'm just telling you the facts. And so that's what it is. And now you got a bunch of folks from Mexico that never got out from under colonialism. You may have gotten rid of the Spanish and the French and then the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, but the system stayed. And so it's a day to just now claim independence over El Norte and run around burning American flags, holding your kids up going, Mexico, Mexico, Mexico. Hey, if Mexico was better than the U.S. and had lower taxes and was a freer country, I'll go down there and I'll Mexico, Mexico, baby. I mean, I'm thinking about going to Switzerland down the road. I don't care what color you are. If I cannot get mugged and put money in the bank and not get robbed and have lower taxes and have prosperity and people be nice, I don't care. But just you're up here yelling Mexico while your country's got 170,000 people dead in the last decade, 100,000 dead, 70-something thousand missing, total bedlam, mass murder, most areas of collapse, women being 80% of the women coming across the border as part of the unspoken payment are raped. But then they have this weird thing at the liberal schools, the colleges, where they teach that gringos are all evil, gringos all rape women, Western culture's all evil, but radical Muslims are wonderful. And the whole super arrogant, macho, machismo stuff that certainly had its place in the frontiers or in ancient Spain, you know, when the Muslims are invading, whatever, that's all cute and funny, you know, women being kept like property and the men slapping the women around and cheating on their wives and raping 80% of them. But then you get up here to the United States, trailblazing women's rights, trailblazing the end of slavery with England, and everybody thinks we invented it. That's the brainwashing of the Ford Foundation and all the rest of it, and it's absolutely ridiculous. So that's where I stand on Cinco de Mayo. I'm all about, it's July 4th, throw the foreign globalist out. But Texas has had 8 flags over it, not 6. And there really isn't a claim by Mexico over the Southwest. I mean, you had a few missions in California, a few in Arizona, a few in West New Mexico, a few in Texas, and most of them were deserted before the Spanish even pulled out of Mexico. And then you got Santa Anna, such a bloodthirsty, crazy dictator that Mexico lost a third of its country. Guatemala and south was Mexico. I mean, is that my fault too? Did the United States steal that from Mexico? Mexico was a colony with natives being used as slaves. They just didn't call it slavery. But if you didn't do your work, they'd burn you alive. I always love in the Mexican-American studies they teach, Mexico was against slavery and against the evil of America. I mean, you know, it's just, I just know too much history. And you notice I said many of the people going west, the first waves of those were crazed fighters. People like Davy Crockett and folks were foaming at the mouth when it came to wanting to fight. I mean, they were really intelligent, tough people, but they wanted fights. They wanted to go out and engage large groups of people. I mean, it was written about by the French who were on the Indian side a lot of the times. Like, you know, Sam Houston with 5 arrows sticking out of him in Tennessee, like killing like 12 people with a hatchet. I mean, they loved it. We'll be back. I was talking to Alejandra during the break, and she was correcting me, and she was reminding me, because I know she's correct, because I've read about this controversy a lot, and I just went off Wikipedia today that said Cinco de Mayo is the most important holiday in Mexico concerning its sovereignty. But I've always heard it's big in the United States, and that down there it's not Cinco de Mayo, but how do you say it? Día de Seis. And I don't speak Spanish well. I speak very little. But she said, no, that's right. That's correct. She's from Mexico. By the way, she does a great job, too. And so that's what this is all coming down to, is how our media basically creates all these new combines and all these new things and then sells it as reality. And that's why I've always seen Cinco de Mayo as this weird get El Norte thing here in the United States that is basically run by the mainstream media to create more balkanization. But I bet you know more than I do. So thanks for reminding me that I was going off mainstream media and was wrong, Allie.
Yeah, no problem. I've noticed that ever since I came to the United States, Cinco de Mayo is a big deal. And in Mexico, we only celebrate 16th of September, which is the independence. And it happened in 1810. And then Puebla, that battle that the Cinco de Mayo represents, it was actually in 1861. So it was actually way later when Mexico was suffering some financial problems, and Britain and Spain they made like a good deal with Mexico, but the friends, they were like, oh, let's take the opportunity and take over Mexico. And that's when Napoleon III was like, oh yeah, I'm going to take over. And it was just a battle that we won and everything. And it's not like a huge deal. It was just more like, oh,
so why do you think the media up here says it's the main Mexican holiday? Because I knew that was the case, but I still went ahead and just read what they say.
I think from what I know, and I think most people found it as like a way to celebrate, or like just celebrate and enjoy party. The party scene.
I hear you. And so the Ford Foundation, others are trying to grab it. Yeah. So the real Independence Day from Spain, that's called Día de Seis. Am I saying it wrong?
Yeah, Día de Seis de Septiembre.
Okay, good. I mean, so I'm totally butchering it then.
No, you didn't get it, I promise.
Okay, all right. Well, my dad always talks about that because he's a big historian, and so is my mom, and they're always just irritated when they hear Cinco de Mayo, the main Mexican holiday, and they're just like, that's not the holiday. They don't celebrate that in Mexico. That's all bull, and here I am getting it wrong. And that's why we have a great crew, folks, to correct me when I am wrong. Thank you so much, Allie.
No problem.
But I was right. This is literally something celebrated in El Norte for people to run around and burn pinatas of Donald Trump, which is in the news today up on Infowars.com. I haven't gotten to the whole coal thing yet. These are some riveting clips, very, very sad clips of these coal miners losing everything. And it's good, clean energy we need. And sorry, bye-bye. But meanwhile, this story just went up on Infowars.com. Roger Stone, Infowars supporters, helped make the Trump revolution. Trump is a force of nature. He's not going to be stopped, a new article and blurb by Roger Stone, and nice little comments he's made up on Infowars.com. And the mainstream media has really picked up on that. They've been trying to demonize Trump's affiliation with us and his campaign's affiliation with us and others, and Trump has not run away from it. He said a lot of nice things on the campaign trail. I know he's intending to come on soon, but that's not that big a deal. We're promoting the ideas of Donald Trump, and I've got some clips that I'm going to get to, and then I'm going to get to the situation with the coal, where Hillary has been caught in flagrant lies and disinformation. I'm Alex Jones. This is the GCN Radio Network. Infowars.com is the news site with so much key breaking news. Back in 70 seconds. Then we've got James O'Keefe and Wayne Madsen joining us. All right, coming up, James O'Keefe's going to join us. After he leaves us at the bottom of the hour, I've got to get to all these coal clips because there's five different clips. There's Hillary saying we're going to get rid of the coal miners and get rid of coal. Then she said she never said that. Then she said that, no, I mean, we're going to save you. That's what my statement means. But then her policies and Obama's policies have been to, quote, bankrupt coal in this country. And it's really got the coal miners upset, and people are really clicking that Hillary is out to get the little person. I mean, there aren't harder working people that work in more danger than coal miners around the world, whether it's in Latin America, Europe, the United States, and now they can't even have their ancestral job that many of them have had in places like England, some families, for 300 years. They've been mining coal for almost 180 years in West Virginia and Kentucky. It's incredible. That's globalism. Stroke of the pen, your job's gone. And people go, I don't care, I'm not a coal miner. Well, guess what? Your energy prices just went up. So incredible. But let's go to some of these clips I mentioned earlier, some of the good stuff Trump's doing. And why he's got the establishment so scared of him. Trump's doubled down to coming out saying repeal Obamacare, it's a total disaster. I wish he'd go further and say it's been great for the big insurance companies, ripping everybody off who wrote it. That's how you destroy it. You kill the left cover. It's not free health care. It increases premiums. And then poor people that can still get charity care go, well, I got free care. They just call that Obamacare. Oh, man. Remember Obama said over and over again that it would be free and you could keep your doctor? I mean, the insurance companies wrote it. And I'm all for free market businesses and companies and stuff. But, man, insurance companies are as dirty as it gets internationally. You think they... Oh, by the way, though, it's the first 4 or 5 years they make a profit. Next year, it goes up so much, though, and is so uncompetitive, they're then allowed to selectively pull out of it. So really, Obamacare is like a 5-year screw job. That's how you decode it. But guess what? A lot of people aren't going to be able to opt out, though. The insurance companies can opt out of giving you coverage, but you can't opt out of getting it no matter how much it costs. I mean, boy, you talk about having your hands tied, written by the insiders. Baby, this is it. But let's go to the short clip. Trump vows to repeal the total disaster Obamacare on CNBC.
In terms of the Affordable Care Act and just health care in the country, another first 100 days issue, would you immediately try to...
Well, if you go back to when this was originally passed, I said, whoever... This was long before I thought about running for president. I said, 2016 and 2017, and particularly 17, is going to be a total disaster for our country because of the so-called Affordable Care Act, Obamacare. And it is a disaster. And I've been saying it. I said, whoever's president's going to have a problem because the numbers are going to be staggering for not only for people and not only for insurance companies, for the country. I mean, look at the kind of numbers we're talking about for the country. And the fact is you have to repeal and replace Obamacare. The country cannot afford it. People cannot afford it. It's good for almost no one. And we have to repeal it, and we have to replace it, and we have to get it. We have to get better. Frankly, we have to get better than what we have right now, because what we have right now isn't working.
Sure.
Look at the premiums that people apply. Forget the insurance companies. The premiums are going up 25%, 35%, 45%, and sometimes more than that. And look at the deductible. Deductibles are going up to numbers that nobody can even believe. I mean, you have to almost die to be able to even use it. It's a horrible thing for the country. I hear for the insurance companies, and I certainly know for the people, because their numbers are going up so high and so rapidly. It is a total failure. It is a disaster.
Except for the globalists. He said almost nobody. We're going to break. He said it's really bad for almost everyone. Oh, it's real good for the global insurance companies that in the first year of it being implemented, global profits went up. James O'Keefe of Project Veritas is stuck in traffic. He should be in his office in the next 3-4 minutes. We'll punch him up on Skype and get him here on the broadcast. He shot the viral video last week that went up on Drudge and other major sites. Video, North Carolina officials enable reporters posing as tranny bathroom sexual predators. They come in and say, I like to get in bathrooms with women. I've got a fetish. It's sexual. And they say, listen, don't incriminate yourself. Stop talking. Go enjoy yourself, basically. And this is what this is all about. Obama's threatening North Carolina over, you know, saying that men use men's bathrooms, women use women's bathrooms, while they announced that Obamacare premiums are set to double again. While they announce that they're going to bring in record numbers of Muslims into the country with no vetting, and while they announce U.S. jobless claims rising, layoffs intensifying, we're all being distracted with this type of garbage. Meanwhile, the Daily Mail reports that they have, I guess, elected their first Muslim mayor of London. In fact, we'll put that headline up. It's on Drudge Report. It's also on Infowars.com. And then meanwhile, women should not be allowed to travel more than 48 miles without a male chaperone, says British Muslim group. And they're pushing for that. Hearts of London now 50% Islamic, doubles in a decade. What will it be? Well, I guess 80% in a decade. Could be majority within 10 years. And the issue is the majority of Muslims now, the dominant Islam, is radical Islam that politically, culturally, economically, militarily, physically comes after you. First Muslim mayor of Londonistan. Isn't that just special? Labour set. So they're saying it's all done. He's so many 20-something points ahead. Labour, that's the Communist Party basically over there, is set to recapture London after bitter mayoral campaign. Reuters. Sekhmet Khan, their candidate, was set today to become the first Muslim to be elected mayor of London, loosening the ruling conservatives' hold on Britain's financial center after a campaign marred by charges of anti-Semitism and extremism. Here's what I know. There isn't a Muslim country on earth that allows anyone of any other major religion to be in a major governmental position or elected other than Iraq and Saddam Hussein. He wanted Playboy on the store shelves, rock and roll on the radio, and women going to college. He was a former CIA operative put in by Eisenhower as an assassin, then installed later in 79, told to invade, told to attack Iran, told to go ahead and invade Kuwait and set up. That's what he got because they were getting rid of that old policy of trying to westernize the Middle East. And you said, no, we're not doing it. You're not going to have, and I'm not saying it's good to have Playboy on the store shelves, but it's people's rights if they want to. You know what I mean? But he's the opposite of head chopping Saudi Arabia, his arch enemy. And he's deader than doornail now, dug out of his spider hole. The media calling Saddam a coward. You read about that guy's life? Far from a coward. Very interesting person. Very brutal to people that tried to kill Jews and Christians and non-radical Muslims. Very brutal to people that wanted to blow up women going to college. Saddam didn't like his daughters going around wearing hoods over their heads. Sorry, didn't like it. But I know mustaches are out, big beards are in, and that's what dominant Islam is now pushing. The Ba'ath Party wasn't perfect, but it tried to modernize the Middle East. That's why it was the big enemy of the globalist, and it has been basically taken out. Who else is Ba'ath? Assad. Assad. The only other country that where you could have Muslims and Christians living in peace, along with Jews, and now that's been destroyed, basically. So that's who our government runs. That's who our government protects, and they bring them in, let them attack us. And I've been in London a lot. The Muslims are so arrogant and aggressive, you'll be videotaping Big Ben, and they'll run over and say, you do not tape me! Do you understand? And you're like, hey, buddy, free speech, I'll do what I want. And then they back off because they're so used to Brits. And I'm not knocking Brits. They used to be the toughest people in the world. They're so politically correct, they almost start urinating on themselves. Just, yes, sir, so I called you brown. Let me bow to you. Oh, yes, sir, Lord Chip. I mean, that's what this has turned to. So while we're busy trying to create special bathrooms and letting men into bathrooms and colleges are, you know, shredding constitutions and banning them because they're so evil and racist, as James O'Keefe has documented, all over the world we're bringing in people who fundamentally say your daughter shouldn't be able to leave home, shouldn't be able to drive a car, and we're going to enforce it, and your women belong to us, you dumb, weak Europeans. And the weird leftist, radical, La Raza feminist are always celebrating Islam and all this weird craziness. Now, the story is up on Infowars.com, and I'm just going to have the man himself introduce it. It's also, obviously, at ProjectVeritas.com, one of their latest coups, the folks that brought down Acorn and other vicious organizations. And there's shades of that, where James O'Keefe walks in with a so-called hooker, and he goes, I got underage sex slaves I want to run. And they go, well, just cover it up. Good job. We'll help, you know, run this operation with you. That's what we do here in the Democratic Party. You went to facility after facility, just like they went around Texas and the Democrats went, the white Democrats, to a person. We're going to have election fraud and take over and bring in Mexicans and overthrow the state, and we'll get the guns. Don't worry. I mean, this is a crazed groups with what I call criminal energy, criminal intent. They're conquerors. It's all these weird radical Muslims, weirdo groups, pedophile groups, NAMBLA at the UN. They're taking over. So we've got a 3.5-minute video, but let's play just the short 1-minute long boil down of this and then have O'Keefe break it down for us and talk about election 2016, where he sees it all going and more. But here's part of that report.
Excited to put it down.
I'm not one of the transgender people. I do it for the women.
Okay. I like being in a guy's bathroom. There's guys in there.
Yeah.
I like guys.
So it's a turn on?
Yeah.
For better or worse, it's a bit of a fetish.
Are you familiar with Snapchat? You know, I'll like take a snap in the bathroom. My friend's like, oh my God, you're so gross.
I can be a little bit bad and it's sort of pushes the envelope.
So, you know, I mean,
there has been some Snapchats, but they self-destruct.
Well, they don't really self-destruct.
I hope they self-destruct.
Like, nope. You're taking Snapchats of women. You're alerting me to what we call sexual exploitation. Yeah. Don't tell me anything more. Yeah. Don't tell me anything more.
Say anything.
When people take, don't say it. Just listen.
All right. Now, that audio may not transfer too good over AM, but it transfers pretty clear on FM and the internet. But to go over it is James O'Keefe. The president's big issue now is North Carolina saying we're not going to have 6'5" men that self-identify as a 5-year-old girl, in the bathroom with your daughter. This is now the ultimate issue. The feds are threatening civil rights lawsuits, arrest. That's in the news today. While they're bringing in hundreds of thousands of people that say they want to put a beekeeper suit over your wife and daughter's head. I mean, this is crazy town. And then to watch these university officials kind of giggle and laugh about taking photos of people going to the bathroom, which is a whole liberal perv universe. This is all just a bunch of pervs, in my view, that want to get laws passed to be able to do whatever they want. This is what happens when civilization is about to collapse. James O'Keefe of Project Veritas, do you agree with that statement, or what would you add to it?
I think it's, Alex, thanks for having me on again. Yeah, the video shows these officials at these North Carolina state officials, because this is all happening in North Carolina, that the gender-neutral bathrooms could actually be used as a cover for sexual predators. So we went straight to the heart of this whole controversy by sending in people undercover, posing as sexual predators, talking to these not just like low-ranking officials. These are chancellors of universities, provosts, Title IX officials. So what we have here is the Title IX federal laws that require people to feel comfortable, require any federal program from receiving federal assistance. There's no discrimination on the basis of sex. There's no denial of feeling comfortable. But we just have these Title IX officials in conflict with the gender-neutral bathrooms. They cannot coexist. So we expose this by going in and saying, hey, we want to use these restrooms. Of course, we're posing as these predators. We want to use these female restrooms because it gets us turned on to use them and to take photographs in there. And they tell us, don't say anything more about it. Don't talk about it, when they should be calling the police. One official actually encourages us to keep doing it creatively. And then, of course, there's the cover up of this. And we'll talk about that, too, because the video came out and then they went scrambling. So we're trying to get to the heart of the matter here, which is about that these gender neutral bathrooms have their positive characteristics, but it could be an enabler for sexual predators.
And by the way, I was out at dinner the other night, and my daughters, who are 11 and 8, wanted me to go to the bathroom with them, which they hadn't done in years. And they pointed at the bathrooms, you know, walk with them, because they could see them. And they could see that it said gender neutral. And here in Austin, they'd just done it. There wasn't a choice. And then I went, well, guys, that's okay. I think that's a single-person bathroom. I went and looked. It wasn't. I mean, this is crazy town. What they've done.
Yeah, well, in the video, it's both, you know, enlightening, enraging, and funny in a dark way. Because in the video, I was in there. I was actually doing this hidden camera work this time. And I said to the official, I said, well, there have been some Snapchat photographs that were taken in these women's bathrooms. And she says, oh, really? And I said, well, they self-destruct, don't they? They disappear after a few minutes or after a few hours. And she said, well, they're on some server somewhere. And I said, I hope they self-destruct, because otherwise I'm going to get in trouble. And she says, well, don't say she cover, you know, don't covers her ears. Don't tell me anything else. When the state laws and the federal laws says that that's exactly what she's supposed to do. But she doesn't want this incident to get in the way of a broader desire, which is to keep the status quo, keep these restrooms being used.
Sure. Well, let's expand on that, though. This is about taking all of our other liberties, all of our other freedoms in this country, the private Federal Reserve, the banker bailouts, the NSA spying, the open borders, the lawlessness, and giving us these new little weird rights that never existed. It's a giant joke on us. But I didn't realize that this has become a huge issue in schools and culture. I hadn't talked to my daughters about this. And there I was suddenly in a normal supposed restaurant, and they've changed it now. And my children were concerned and scared. I mean, I'll say where I was. I was at a Cheesecake Factory, folks. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's actually affecting me now. I can't believe it. And they're scared. They don't want to be in a bathroom with strange men. I get it. I don't really like, I always go in a, you know, communal bathroom and go, oh, good, there's nobody in here, you know? I don't like being around other men, quite frankly, you know, with their pants off or whatever. I mean, I'll just be honest. Or women, for that matter, if it's not my wife or whatever. It's creepy. Whatever happened to privacy? In the old Soviet Union, they only took, you know, your wages away and made you work as a slave. You could at least go home and be a man, be a woman, have kids, and just be normal. What is happening here? These people are trying to conquer us. What's behind this, James O'Keefe?
Well, hell, that's a great question. You know, it's a broader question. I think I genuinely think that you're seeing the collision of two different competing philosophies. And one of those philosophies, like Title IX, which is a controversial program, it says that no person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded in participation of or denied the benefits of or subjected to discrimination under any education program or activity. And these Title IX philosophies have become so pushed upon these universities and these organizations. And now you're seeing the conflict. Now you're seeing people want to do nefarious things, sneak into other restrooms, become predators, and they're not able to coexist. So, and we did it with Lucky Charms, trying to ban Lucky Charms because they're racist. We've done it with campus speech codes, with the campus being banned at Yale University. They banned the Halloween costumes. I mean, 10 years ago, this was irony. Now it's become reality.
And they fired the professors that spoke up and who were liberals and said we should allow costume parties.
We had a student at Yale University walk up to, this was on video, walk up to one of the deans and say, and she said to the dean, she says, your job is to create a safe space here. And the dean says, I don't agree with you. To his credit, he said, the job is the marketplace of ideas. And she screamed at him and she cursed at him and she said, then you should be fired. And eventually one of those people did resign. So you have everything's coming to a boiling point in this country, and there are competing philosophies, some of which are on the left competing with each other about safe spaces, about the ability to peep in restrooms. And we're just trying to expose it. We're trying to visualize it for people, and we're trying to acknowledge it. Now, Alex, after we did this report, we wanted to know what was happening afterwards. We called them for comment. This is the chancellor of UNC, and they submitted a police report. But the interesting thing about the police report is, guess what?
You're in it.
It was filed after the fact. And we know that it was filed after the fact. So they're trying to cover up their tracks, which is, you know, just another story.
Oh, I'm surprised they didn't try to charge you and say that covering it's what's evil. But at least they're trying to act like they're doing the right thing. Well, what about the pro-life groups that clearly have been exposing some criminal activity? We now know about the body part sales. We now, the women aren't being told. They're in a national service. They're getting arrested from California to Texas in SWAT team raids.
So David DeLeiden is the one that you're talking, he's a friend of mine, he's a colleague of mine, and he was actually, he was raided, his home was raided 3 weeks ago by the California Attorney General's office while he was taking his trash out during lunchtime. I think they had a dozen state attorney general. This is Kamala Harris, who's running for Senate in California, who's currently the attorney general of California. 12 state agents to raid. They took all of his video cameras. They took all of his equipment. And they want to try to prosecute this citizen journalist for exposing Planned Parenthood. It's all political. It's all political. And just so that your audience knows, Veritas, my organization, does have an ongoing undercover investigation into the California Attorney General's office, because it's absolutely unconscionable that these agents are playing politics. Their job is to enforce law, not to retaliate against people for their journalistic.
I agree. It's not just there. They had folks down in Houston pull an indictment of journalists. This is getting dangerous for the free press.
Yeah, Texas is perceived by like people in the Northeast to be a conservative place, but you guys have Travis County, you have Harris County, you have kangaroo courts, and you have people who do political things. And the only solution that I can see is for people like us, as I've said on your program many, many times, to it's not about pitchforks anymore. It's about video cameras.
I agree. And the answer is more people doing what you've done, what we do. I mean, I say get more people out of these Trump rallies to show how horrible these anti-free speech social justice warriors are. We're not trying to run a monopoly of this. You've written a book about it. You try to teach folks how to do it. We try to do it. We just want more citizen journalists out there because, James O'Keefe, I think it's fair to say we are starting to win. I think people are waking up all over the world, not just here, but the establishment is striking back trying to censor free speech.
Yes, and that is the fight that I fight is they're trying to say that, you know, if CBS News or NBC News shows up with a camera, they're not going to arrest you or detain you. They're not going to try to destroy you. But if we do that, they're going to try to censor us and discredit us. You asked about the election. I'd love to give you my thoughts about what's happening in 2016. You know, I read this book by Charles Murray called By the People, and I think he says it best that our government and country is in such an advanced state of sclerosis and that solutions are far beyond the reach of the electoral and legislative process. And maybe Trump will change things. Maybe this election, someone who gets in will change things. But I do think that the restoration of a great, lasting, and moral society is not going to happen by getting people on the courts or even winning elections. The citizenry must create new counterweights. And those counterweights include the types of things that we're doing. You have to hold the people accountable at the local level. And if it's a UNC provost who's filing false police reports because their people were advising a sexual or a would-be sexual predator, whatever the case is, we have to create the counterweights. We can't put all of our faith in government or in the legislative process.
I totally agree. We shouldn't bet everything on Trump, but his populism and his popularity and the mainstream media throwing everything they've got against him and it backfiring is a good gauge and a bellwether of just how discredited these people are. I mean, the AP poll, 6% of Americans trust the mainstream media. That's stick a fork in it. It's done.
I will tell you that, you know, anyone who's saying that Trump can't beat Hillary, I mean, these people have been wrong about every single thing. They have lied, and in most cases, they have a fiduciary interest. They have a stake in the game. They have skin in the game.
Oh, Trump's going to destroy her because he's going to take the gloves off.
Right, but the people have been wrong, and you see in the articles come out now, and the Washington Post, Chris Eliza, come out and says, I've been wrong. They're printing their mea culpas, but they've been wrong about every single thing. Do not believe them. Whatever advice they give you in the media about what's going to happen here, it's probably the exact opposite. And I do think that people are waking up, Alex. I do think that people are really upset, and our job is to keep them informed. And I'm happy that people are finally able to not trust the information that they're given. And this whole process, this whole election, has made people distrust these folks even more. And as much as we can do to inform the people directly, that's what we got to do.
I agree with you. What else are you working on that's big? When's the next shoe drop?
Absolutely. Well, we have a lot of things going on. We're saving our best stuff for August, September, because that's when the general election is. But we do have people. I've said this publicly. I'll say it again. We have people who are employed by Hillary Clinton's campaign, like paid by her campaign. People who are working with me, citizen journalists, who have gotten jobs with Hillary Clinton's campaign, and they record 8 hours of video. And they send it back to our servers. We also have servers in Westchester, New York. Their Project Veritas server, not in Chappaqua.
You got a lot of guts.
And we have these people reporting and showing the infighting in the campaign, what they're talking about in the campaign, and that will all be released come August and September.
I tell you, you're a man's man, and so is your crew. A lot of amazing people there. Mr. O'Keefe, we want to absolutely just say Godspeed, ProjectVeritas.com. And hey, you know we love you. Please give us some of those exclusives, or at least come on the day all that breaks. I know that you're out there working so hard. Thank you for all the hard work, sir.
Will do. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I really admire that guy. That guy is a rock star, superstar when it comes to journalism and defending freedom. He's an example for us all. Says his organization, pray for him, support him. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com. Camille Paglia, who is a true intellectual, I've read several of her books, a lot of her writings, she actually knows what she's talking about, has come out and said, Hillary wants to make this all about sexism and all about women versus men. This is about elitism and bitter garbage and insiders playing games. Donald Trump's the way to go. It doesn't matter that Donald Trump hires more women for executive positions than any other executive out there. They've done studies on it. It doesn't matter that he doesn't have any history of abusing women or anything wrong. They're just going to say he does. While they defend radical Islam that turns women into total slaves. It's not about sexism, she says. Camille Paglia on Trump, Hillary's restless bitterness and the end of elites, a Salon story. It's good to see Salon get it right occasionally instead of promoting pedophilia like they've done in five different articles in the last year. I mean, give me a break. Keep your hands off my kids. Keep your hands off their minds, too, you control freaks. All right, I want to get into the coal mine news that I mentioned because it's not about coal miners. It is, but it's bigger than that. It's about screwing everyone over in their face. But first, I want to get into the Republican establishment saying the Republican Party's dead because of Trump and Herbert Walker Bush and George Bush saying they won't be part of the party because Trump said it. I mean, they say he's discredited it. These are the people bringing in world government, deindustrializing us, that launched all the evil wars that have been rejected, just like we reject Hillary. We don't reject Jeb Bush because he's a white guy. We reject him because he's from a serial killer family and a con man. Same thing with Hillary. And I shouldn't have to sit up here and say, I'm against Hillary because she's an evil person, not because she's a woman. I would vote for a good woman so quick it'd make my head spin. I mean, it's not even debatable. As if the grassroots birthplace of the Renaissance is against women. How did the West ever get to the point where we think we are the creators of all oppression? Because we are where so much of the liberty movement started worldwide. We are the prime suspects because we're so liberal. We love our daughters so much. We love our sons so much. We love everybody. That at least was a large vein of Renaissance culture in the last 500 years. And you just compare the history of the West in the last 500 years to everybody else, and it is enlightened. It is awesome compared. It's got a lot of problems. But it's where the world learned to start trying to truly progress. And then you get this leftist, communist, globalist, anti-human garbage saying they're the progressives. It's scary. I'm going to get to these clips here in a moment and get into the coal mining story and then open the phones up and take some of your calls. You can also call in if you want to talk to Wayne Madsen with any 2016 questions. He's got a lot of breaking news coming up. But first, I kept saying we're extending it one day the last few days, and I just called him up and I said, look, I'm going to stop arguing every day about extending this sale. Our major suppliers in Utah, super high-quality, storable food. I said, I want to get the maximum I can push this contractually as a private labeler and what your factory can supply. They said, okay, at current sales rates, we can go until Sunday. And because our rule at My Patriot Supply is to get it out within a week. And because they're so fresh, such high quality. And we private label be able to sometimes get around their already lowest prices to the very lowest prices in the industry. Because they got a lot of other distributors and suppliers, and quite frankly, a lot of folks don't like prices down there with, 10% profit or whatever. They want 30%, 40%, or 50% and sell less. That's not how I work. I want the deal I'd want. I want a relationship. I want you to get quality food. I want you to enjoy it. I want you to know you got a good deal on it. And I hope you don't ever have to use it with talk of revolution and war and the economy and the bubbles and the elites running into bunkers and all the craziness. I hope that we're prepared, we're ready, and that we don't have to use the storable food. But it's not like insurance you get for fire. You never have a fire for 50 years. Or auto insurance for a decade, you don't have a wreck. You're like, well, at least I didn't ever have a wreck. Yeah, but you wasted all that money. With storable food, let's say things get better in 5 years. You eat it, tastes as good as the day you bought it. Super high quality. This is insurance you don't lose on. In fact, with inflation going up, you probably gain money in many different analyses. So 30 to 40% off, depending on the package. We have the full spectrum of My Patriot and InfoWars Select, exact same food, side by side. You can buy it. My Patriot, their full selection, or you can buy it from InfoWars Select. It's the exact same food. InfoWarsLife.com is the nutraceuticals. InfoWarsSelect.com is the storable food. But you can find it all at InfoWarsStore.com. And because we have sold a lot of food the last 2 weeks, I am in a better position to really send a full crew to Bilderberg next month, to send a giant crew to Cleveland and to the DNC in Philadelphia, and to send a crew to Oregon this weekend to cover the anti-free speech social justice warriors, and to hire a couple more reporters, and to be able to get some bonuses into these well-deserved reporters that, quite frankly, aren't paid that much. So thank you for your support, folks. We are hardcore patriots that love freedom, and whether it's non-GMO heirloom seeds, or whether it's high-quality water filtration systems, or whether it's the super high-quality nutraceuticals, they're all 10% off right now as part of this preparedness special. And I'm going to run that until next Wednesday, and that's the day that ends. But this Sunday it ends to get 30 to 40% off on the high-quality storable foods at InfoWarsStore.com. We sold out of Supermel Vitality. It's just a bunch of known cold-pressed organic herbs that just get your body and your glands operating the way God intended them to. All I know is it's changed my life. I've lost weight, libido, stamina. It's incredible. Quite frankly, I said, look, I know that formulas similar to Super Male that are cold pressed are $100 and ours is basically half that. But I said, I want to come out with a one that is organic but dry herbs. So it's a bigger dose but not as powerful. Kind of a poor man's Super Male Vitality. And it's not a poor man's, but it's very inexpensive. $24, $26. Similar dry powder brands are $80 that you buy at major stores. And they're worth it, in my view. And a lot of folks argue with me in marketing. They go, listen, sell for more. There's more perceived value. I will not play that game ever. I need to be punched in the nose the day I do. Okay? Anyways, the point is, I appreciate you and I appreciate your support. And I want you to be blown away by Anthroplex. Now, be careful with it because I've had some temper issues. I'll just be honest. And I already had them, so you know, if you don't have a temper problem, it's not a game. In fact, consult your physician. This is all seen as FDA grass, recognized safe. That's that whole law. We don't sell anything that isn't seen as grass. And that doesn't mean grass on the ground, folks. It's a law. But still, whether it's the liver cleanse or X2 or Anthroplex, consult a physician because it may interact with something you're taking or whatever. This is powerful stuff. You may detox big time on the liver cleanse. You may detox big time on the X2 nascent iodine because you're already so deficient and your thyroid was already about to go over the edge. So buyer beware. We're not selling sugar water. These aren't placebo. Easter bunny eggs, baby. Okay? Just get that and know it. Experience it for yourself. But after I detoxed it for 3 weeks on Survival Shield X2, it was like when I carry one of my kids and they were little up a big, you know, mountain or something of, you know, a couple thousand feet. And when you finally take your four-year-old off your shoulders, you feel like you're flying. About 3 weeks into this, I felt like crud for about a week. And Dr. Group predicted that. But, man, after that, it was just like all the stuff came out of my skin. Other things happened. I mean, it was spectacular. Because it was an element I needed all along that wasn't available in the food chain, basically, for most people. I know I was deficient. Okay, I'm going to stop plugging right there. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Thank you for your support. And support our affiliates, support our local sponsors, become a sponsor. That's what it's all about. And spread the word. Let's say you don't have two pennies to rub together. Fine. You're incredible. you can take action and send people to Infowars.com/show to find the free video and audio feeds and Droid and iPhone apps that are all free. And the audio and video feeds, you can tell folks about Infowars.com/newsletter to get the videos and the articles sent right to them. You can tell people about the local station you're listening to. Get in the fight. Get off the bench. Realize history's happening. It's only going to get crazier here on out. Let me tell you, it's going to get so crazy that many people you know that wouldn't wake up and wouldn't get involved before, they're going to get involved because the veneer of civilization is peeling off like a heat shield on the space shuttle coming back into orbit and coming back into the atmosphere. All right. I'm going to stop right there. I want to get into the coal mine situation, but first let's cover this. The outrageousness. Here's the CNN article. There's video up on their site. I'm not going to play it here. And you've heard this from all the different parrots, the repeaters, or like a tree of monkeys, all the Republican establishment up there throwing you-know-what at us and telling us it's pumpkin pie. With Trump in, Bush will not participate, close quote, in White House contest. As if that crazy man participates in anything. He was never even president. He was a puppet. Cheney ran the show. President George W. Bush, the fake Texan. I'm just sick of people coming down here and doing it in Texas's name, like Ted Cruz and, you know, George Bush and all these guys. I love folks from Connecticut, but go be criminals in Connecticut. President George W. Bush, LBJ, was a Texan and was a criminal. We get the blame for that one. President Super Texan, he was the real deal, a criminal version. Look out. President George W. Bush is staying out of presidential campaign politics, a spokesman said Wednesday, an announcement that came just after Donald Trump became the Republican Party's presumptive nominee. President Bush does not plan to participate or comment on the presidential campaign, Bush spokesman Freddie Ford told CNN. That's because he's hopped up on so many psychotropics painting in his bathtub. Remember that? That guy is gone, gone, gone. Gone to drink. Gone to pills, gone, gone, gone. I have already drunk your money, he said, to quote True Grit. And it goes on, how the Republican establishment is against him, as if that means something. You have a discredited warmonger saying he doesn't like you, and these other people, and Dick Cheney, and all the rest of them, and I've got one here with John McCain, the Keating Five swindler. It goes on and on. Not a war hero. He was in the lavish area with the prostitutes and the fine meals. He was a guy that said whatever they wanted. I mean, I've interviewed the folks that were in the Hanoi Hilton with him. But he's a war hero, according to these traitors. Well, Glenn Beck, who really is so irrelevant, I don't want to even attack him. I wish he would have turned around. I wish he would have stopped. He has been lying about us 24/7. I've had lawyers look at what he said before, and they said, undoubtedly you'd win this, but you don't want to waste your time doing that, do you? And I said, no, he's so discredited that it doesn't matter what he said about me. What he said about me didn't hurt me. But he always is there to deceive conservatives and libertarians and to defeat movements at key periods. And that was his total commitment, his job to do, even if he destroyed himself. And he is now a shadow of his former self on ratings, you name it, his money, everything. He claims he's real proud of that you know, he did all this. The guy's a piece of work. And he says we'll never have another Republican president now because of Donald Trump. Not because of killing a million Iraqis and George Bush and not Clinton, you know, keeping the sanctions on and killing hundreds of thousands and Albright saying it was okay. Not all the NSA spying, not all the torture, not all the open borders, not all the globalism. None of that matters. All that matters is that Donald Trump said, oh, we can't bring in any Muslims right now if we're not checking their IDs. I didn't know that. Yeah. Oh, hey, well, listen, Mexico has some of the toughest immigration things out there. We've got to control our border. We're allowed to have a border. We got bad deals with China. His mistake was thinking he'd try to be president and just take a few of the bowling balls tied to our legs, the ball and chains off. Because this whole crew, like George Will, says we don't count your votes. We don't listen to the plurality of the people. We are sovereign. That means royal. We're royal. He actually said, we're royal. You don't count. And these collection of bought-off minions get together and just say, we've arrived. We rule like North Korean Communist Party members. You don't think Kim Jong-un knows what an idiot he looks like. Neither does Glenn Beck. He doesn't know what he looks like. He doesn't know how stupid it is to go, congratulations, Ted. The voters have spoke. You just swept 8 states. No voting happened. Of course that backfired on Cruz. We're not that far down the rat hole. Here's what tyrants always do. They push, they push, they push, they push, they push, they push. They get away with it over and over and over again and think these people will put up with anything. There's nothing they won't do. And suddenly Nero goes crazy and just goes, I want my palace to be the whole city. Burn the city. Everybody finds out he did it. He becomes so hated, he supposedly committed suicide. They killed him. Not that the Roman elite were good at that time. They were very corrupt, but he was bad for business. And that's what these people are like. They just don't get that they're out in the open going, I'm wearing a sweater tied around my neck like I'm Thurston Howell and sitting here in a mock Oval Office on a power trip bragging about how I've got the guy that does Oreos and American Idol and Disney. Everyone runs from American Idol and Oreos in your audience. They're political. They're patriots. They're involved. They're awake. They don't want to see you ferrying around, taking your acting lessons and fake crying with all your boyfriends around you, telling us about how you hired someone from mainstream TV. Oh, we're so impressed. Oh, tell us. Did you talk to Jay-Z? Oh, do you know someone in Hollywood? I'm skipping this network break, too. Just doing it. It's a sacrifice. It's a tithe. We're doing it. This guy doesn't care about anything but controlling reality. He wants you to get reality from him. See, I want you to open your eyes up and see reality from your perspective and then tell me what you're seeing. To where? Does that register? Are we pretty much on the same page? Oh, you need a different angle? Oh, wait, you're right from your angle. Thank you for bettering me. Here's what I see. Oh, that bettered you? Good, thank you. We've got a better optics on this. Yeah, how are we going to get this species to the next level? Oh, yeah, you're on the team. Oh, I am too. Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. You see, pro-human, absolutely energized. These are a bunch of backstabbing Eddie Haskell, wannabe cool guys in high school that prey on everyone. And they don't want you out in the light. They don't want you empowered because then you don't need him. And I'm not going to attack him anymore, even though I know they work behind the scenes to get us off stations. They threaten stations we're on, reportedly, that you can't have us if you have him. I mean, so, hey, Glenn, I say we get 10 million YouTube video views a week. I just try to be conservative. It's like 20 million. That's just one venue. I say 5 million Facebooks. It's like 10 million Facebook views. Just the videos, jerk. We're on over 170 stations. We're huge all over the world. We're exploding. We've got all these outlets, TV stations picking us up without us even asking. Hey, but we're exploding. And then you sit over there and you try to act like you're the big mothership and everyone wants what you've got. No, they don't want what you got. And you thought you'd be able to steal the election from the people, regardless of who Trump is. It doesn't matter. You thought you'd sit there and tell people to fast. What is it about these psychopaths that they want to be cult leaders and have fawning groups following them around as God? What is it? And psychopaths always wear little nerdly, non-threatening outfits. They always act real wimpy because they're like raging goblins behind the scenes. But they want to act real, because the prey wants to creep up on you, see? They're real, oh, hi, I'm Glenn Beck. I'm creeping up. Oh, how you doing? See? I'm wearing a little non-threatening outfit. I'm kind of Nellying around. That's all his cover, folks. So let's hear from this Nelly, this candy pants right now. Here he is.
But here's what happens. Because Donald Trump...
Hit pause and rewind that. You know, I actually have a really great voice, but instead I just kind of honk like a goose because I'm tired. I'm exhausted. I'm pouring it all out. I'm having trouble breathing right now. I'm so upset. And a lot of times it's almost unlistenable. I get it. But if I wanted to hear my voice, I consider, yeah, we could really talk about this right now with each other and discuss the whole state of the world and look at different articles and talk about a Pew survey that shows 57% say America first. Why isn't it higher? Why is it only 57% that aren't proud to say it's okay to say your country's first? Who's going to stand up for you if it isn't your country? You organize a system based on what's better for the people, because outside countries will come in and take you over. Hi, it's Alex Jones here, and I want to just sit back real relaxed in a living room to try to put you to sleep here and just listen to me. Everything's going to be all right. I'm really into hypnotism. I've really taken classes on that. He admits he has. To just hear my priest, God says, join me. Let's listen to him. Sitting back with all the mics perfectly tuned. Everything angulated. With him creeping up to the microphone. Creeping up like a vampire, like Nosferatu. She's in her nightgown. He's untying the lace. I mean, you know, just... Whew. Predator! Predator! Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. I mean, alert! 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 He's got like a sheep's outfit on. He's a little skinny, ugly wolf, yellow eyes. Like, shut up, don't do that. Okay. Oh, hi, sheep. Mind if I put my mouth around your neck to love you a bit? Here, let's go to the failed little wolfie. Let's go to him. Here it is.
But here's what happens.
Oh, no, stop. Back it up again. I'm sorry. Here's what happens. I mean, here's what happens when you love your voice. Here, let me talk like him. Infowars.com. Exclusive. Conch. Soros insiders attempt to take over Trump campaign. Establishment in ditch effort to co-op New York billionaire. It's all about, he's going to tell you what happens. He's going to tell you the reality. Oh, he's always in the hospital. Feel sorry for me. Buy my products. I'm in the hospital. I'm really skiing, but I'm in the hospital. I'm wearing a new little sweater with a smiley face. Get in my ice cream truck. Oh, hi, little girl. I've got free ice cream inside. Oh, mommy said don't. What about the little puppy? Ever seen a Cheweenie? My name's Glenn Beck. Do you know about what happened to my mommy? Let's go ahead and go back to Glenn Beck.
But here's what happens.
Oh, here's what happens. Back him up again. I'm sorry. Here's what happens. Now, here's what happens. Let's go back to him. Here it is.
But here's what happens. Because Donald Trump is the GOP candidate, and I believe Hillary Clinton is going to win because of this, you will never elect another GOP person to high office ever again.
Which was his mission.
Because what's going to happen is you are now going to have Hillary Clinton legalize as many voters as you can. Mm-hmm. The GOP is going to be completely racist, whether it's true or not, because of Donald Trump. You will never have another Republican president ever again.
All right, let me say this to him and his whole fake authoritarian garbage. Let me be totally insincere and try to be like an actor and just say, here's what's going to happen to you, Glenn Beck. Talk radio is moving into its final phases in the old format. And you are universally reviled by everyone you work with because what a nasty narcissist, messiah complex person you are. And you're going to accelerate towards bankruptcy. And the Republican Party, run by neocon, warmongering Rockefeller Republicans who've been hijacking the party for the social engineers, are going to be run out of the party. And you better hope you don't push too far and many of you end up getting arrested for treason. And we're going to expose your globalist plan with China and others that have sold out our industrial base. And we're going to restore this republic and defeat the social justice warriors and the sickening engineers that hope to bring this country down. And we're going to secure our borders. We're going to deport the criminal illegals and promote good, legal, honest immigration and promote Americana once again. And we're going to bring back the 1950s culture of family, but in a modern, inclusive way for everyone. And we're going to be Americana 1776 worldwide. And the reign of globalist manipulating and controlling the two-party duopoly is over. And you are over. And you are discredited. And you're circling the toilet bowl. And it's well known that you've announced you want to move to Israel or something to claim you're a Messiah. Because even though you have a much smaller audience, you can then milk millions out of each family that's there, hundreds of thousands, and that basically then maybe you'll tell them all to wear Nike tennis shoes, drink barbiturates and vodka, and fly off to Hail Bop. Glenn Beck, your next stop is Hail Bop Cult, filth. You little rat, you've been destroyed. You destroyed yourself. Just like a face in the crowd, you disingenuous traitor to humanity, you piece of crap, you rat filth. I'm going to play the coal mine pieces coming up in the next segment, then have Madsen on about 15 after, and then take your calls. But when you talk about Beck, he's a true Benedict Arnold, a true Slimer, trying to undermine Constitution, Bill of Rights, trying to deceive and get evangelicals on his bandwagon under his mind control. That's clear. He's destroyed himself. But people like Piers Morgan, that's a pure mercenary. So I've noticed Piers Morgan the last few months sounds like Alex Jones on almost every subject. That's because he has no audience and has nowhere to go. And is trying to get a job with Fox News, little birdie told me. But Piers Morgan, Trump slaying D.C. elite, Hillary shaking in her Goldman Sachs finance boots. Well, I mean, Morgan went in and took over Larry King's show that had declined because of the rest of CNN's programming, but still had 4 million viewers on good nights, 2 million regularly, and brought it down to about 300,000. His biggest night ever was when I was on. He had highest ratings for 2 weeks after. That was a like the Death Star blowing up. It looks bigger, but it's actually blown up. That's a dead cat bounce. And so now he comes out and tries to sound like Alex Jones, and people all report on it because, you see, they have to have any pertinence to be in the game. This is called changing the culture from within. It's called dominating. It's called berserking. You know, I'm not of the school of gonzo journalism to try to make myself a story, but when you are in the school of berserk journalism and truth journalism, you will become the story. You will become the narrative. You will become the culture. You will become the civilization. You will become the planet. You will become the future. You will become the victory. You will become the success, because nothing succeeds like success. And they've tried and tried. They had full control. But their attempt to knock out any resistance, their attempt to kill any final embers of humanity, will and is the undoing of the globalist system. So we'll take your calls with Wayne Madsen at the bottom of the hour. If you'd like to queue up linebacker, Operation Goblin Possum. Toll-free number. That doesn't have any secret meaning. I'm just being silly. I was just thinking about Glenn Beck. He is the embodiment of like a Stay Puft Marshmallow Man, like a fake rubber android body. And really, it's just some like computer program of like a obnoxious frat leader or something trying to act arrogant. A beta male trying to act dominant is what we're dealing with here. True alpha males are seething with energy and aggression and intelligence to points they can't even control it. Their guts metaphorically snapping like giant saltwater crocodile jaws, constantly trying to govern the tectonic volcanic forces of white-hot magma spewing into the galaxy. And then they're the little piggy-eyed wimps that get together in little piggy clubs and try to piggy and slime around and go, "We decide the election. You don't have any power. I mean, that's who these people are. Floating around, just little ticks. Supping. All right, I'm sorry. Let's go to break with another clip. I'm going to come back with the whole Cole story that's so important. And then I'm going to get to our next guest. This is Trump on the radical Muslims pouring in, destroying Europe. Here it is.
Do you still believe that Muslims should be banned
pause.
From it?
Hit pause. Another nobody, beta male, wannabe elitist. You know, do you still believe? Just, you know, do you still, like, you're so pathetic. Look, you still act, you're so pathetic after you're defeated.
Dale Earnhardt, you just won another major race, Daytona. You still think you still, here, let's go to that. Here it is.
Do you still believe that Muslims should be banned from entering the country until we can figure out what's going on, as you've said?
We have to be very vigilant. We have to find out exactly what's going on. We have some major, major problems, and nobody wants to talk about it. We have a president that won't mention the term radical Islamic terrorism. He won't even mention it, even though it's obvious that some terrible things are happening. And we have to be extremely careful, and we have to be vigilant. Yes, we have to find out what the hell is going on.
So that proposal stands for the general election, assuming you make it that far.
We'll be back. Stay with us. That guy's not that bad, that reporter. I shouldn't be so mean. All right, let me get reset here and get focused as we're live. We got Wayne Madsen coming up in 5 minutes. It's incredible. We see the globalists moving our jobs to India, Mexico, China, and 100 other plus third world countries to see the Bush family soar over Trump, saying they won't support him. That is a godsend. Who wants a bunch of war criminals, world government globalists, the daddy Bush that moved our jobs to China first, made the deal with them back when he was ambassador to China? Probably a Chinese communist double agent. He was the first U.S. ambassador to China once relations were opened. This is amazing. And now they've shut off over 1,000 of our coal power plants. Obama said he'd bankrupt coal. And the media runs around saying he never said that. That's their goal. That's their plan. Because it competes with all the other energy giants. It lowers prices. And if other folks have cheap energy, what will they do? Outcompete us. No one will develop here, build here because of that. But don't worry, as long as they keep that in place, Hillary and the Bushes and all them get good deals. So along comes Trump. He says, hey, forget the carbon taxes. Forget shutting down our plants. I won't do it. Forget these unfair trade deals. Forget the tariffs. I'm not going to do it. And they say, racist, the communist Chinese. So let's play a clip of Hillary. Quote, we're going to put a lot of coal miners and coal companies out of business. Now she claims she meant to say that to warn people, even though her policies are shut it all down. Here it is.
I'm the only candidate which has a policy about how to bring economic opportunity using clean, renewable energy as the key into coal country, because we're going to put a lot of coal miners and coal companies out of business. Right, Tim? And we're going to make it clear that we don't want to forget those people. Those people labored in those mines for generations, losing their health, often losing their lives to turn on our lights and power.
So that's the spin. We're going to give you windmills and scams that bankrupted Spain and other areas of the United States as well, things that admittedly don't work. But the boondoggle works. The billions per project given to the little insiders, those work very, very nicely. So she's acting like, here, I'm going to chop your legs off. Here's some crutches. But Obama was very, very clear, as candidate Obama, 3 months before he was elected president, in this clip of what the main game plan was. Here it is.
So if somebody wants to build a coal power plant, they can. It's just that it will bankrupt them because they're going to be charged a huge sum for all that greenhouse gas that's being emitted.
And who makes the carbon money? Who's on the Chicago Mercantile? He's set to make billions himself. Talk about racketeering. Now, let's get to the new clips here. Because now the coal miners are coming after her. We've got three of these clips, and we're going to Wayne Madsen. But this is what's really happening. And again, a lot of folks go, well, I don't care if coal gets bankrupt. There's enough coal for 1,000 years at our current rate here that's been discovered. It burns completely clean in the scrubbers. Nothing comes out. And all the byproducts can be used to make steel and other alloys. Nothing goes to waste. Coal is magic good. But this country doesn't have one lead smelting plant. You can say that's toxic. You need it for a lot of different things. Don't worry. All the bullets can be made in China now, but Obama can sign an order banning the importation of bullets. See? Oh, outside of law, but he's the president. Stroke of the pen, law of the land, kind of cool, huh? Yeah, kind of cool if you're Adolf Hitler wannabe. Let's go to this next clip of the coal miners, what they have to say about Herr Hitlery.
She said, and she did not make it a secret, that she is going to continue with the policies of the past 7.5 years and expand upon them. There's no other way to perceive that. Pure and simple, we are doomed.
I feel like she is basically just stabbing us in the back. I mean, how can you say that you're going to put us all out of work, the coal companies, bankrupt the coal companies, and come here and lie to our face the way she did? I have nothing for her, and as a matter of fact, I agree with our mayor. She can just stay out, and both Clintons can stay out of our state.
And that's because the clips are there. She's now come and said, I didn't mean that. You're going to have your coal jobs. Don't worry. See, that's spending work. I'm going to shut you down and give you a job at one of the windmills. Yeah, we bet you are. Those companies are all foreign owned. It's all about screwing the American worker. Because we were too uppity. We had guns. They want to make us dependent. This is a 60-year project to make us dependent and dumb us down. And hadn't they done a great job? Here's another one. Coal miner confronts Hillary face to face. Here it is.
I just want to know how you can say you're going to put a lot of coal miners out of jobs and then come in here and tell us how you're going to be our friend. Because those people out there don't see you as a friend.
I know that, Bo. And, you know, I don't know how to explain it other than what I said was totally out of context from what I meant, because I have been talking about helping coal country for a very long time. And I did put out a plan last summer. And it was a misstatement, because what I was saying is that the way things are going now, we will continue to lose jobs. That's what I meant to say, and I think that that seems to be supported by the facts. I didn't mean that we were going to do it. What I said was that is going to happen unless we take action to try to help and prevent it. So I don't mind anybody being upset or angry. That's a perfect right for people to feel that way. I do feel a little bit sad and sorry that I gave folks the reason or the excuse to be so upset with me, because that is not what I intended.
Shut her up. I mean, look at that evil sincerity of that witch. I mean, please, child, come get in the car. I got free candy. I mean, that is a vampire saying, get in the car, get in the car. Put the handcuffs on. I'm Ted Bundy. You're going to love my Volkswagen. You're going to love my dungeon. You know, I came, I saw Gaddafi died. You killed all the Christians. You murdered them. You overthrew the country. These are monsters. You know, she's a Brian Williams up in the plane getting shot at and flying into Macedonia or flying into the Balkans. I mean, in a crowd of evil people, she's one of the worst ever. But she comes out and says, we're getting rid of coal. Since then, they've shut down 1,000 plants or more. They admit that's their plan. She goes, that's not what I meant. You're going to keep your coal and get other stuff. No, they've been shutting it down. And it's not like they're shutting down something that's obsolete, like whale oil. I'm all for them finding other forms of oil or plant oil to run lanterns and not kill all the whales. It's not like, you know, we got rid of something that was bad and got something good. I'd be for progress. No. Coal is the cheapest thing we got, and it's totally clean now with the technology on record. And it's our prices have gone up. It's austerity. Obama said you can't have a car, can't have air conditioning. Remember? But he's going to fly around. It's austerity. It's slavery. It's making you so poor and so dumbed down you can't resist them. And they're in a whole other world, in a breakaway civilization. I want to get into the big developments on the campaign. I want to get into big breaking news, exclusive Koch Soros insiders attempt to take over Trump campaign, Infowars.com. But first, getting into Hillary, getting into coal. He'll be with us the rest of the hour with Wayne Madsen and WayneMadsenReport.com. What is your take on Hillary overall?
Well, I'm telling you, I mean, after the last several months of pinpointing issues with Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz, and others are refocusing now on Hillary. And that's easy because we have a track record with her. But I think it's safe to say that there'll be some other scandals that people have not heard about. We're not talking about the email stuff or the other stuff, but when she was the first lady, and she might have been upset with her husband Bill and his extracurricular affairs, but there's going to be some focus on her own as first lady.
Well, didn't she just get mad if it was a woman she wanted and was jealous of Bill? I mean, she would kind of like two guys getting in a fight over a girl, is what I've been told. Is that correct?
Yeah. Well, she made a few trips. One in particular I'm looking at, and others in October 1998. I would just tell people to stand by for that expose. Which,
sure. Well, you did the whole deal looking if Cruz was connected to JFK. We know he was there and the rest of it. That's big national news. So much of what you've broken becomes national news and gets vetted later. What else is on your radar?
Well, I still think the aftermath of this Cruz leaving the campaign so suddenly after he said we're going to take it to California, we're going to take it to Cleveland. What I've been told is that people associated with the Central Intelligence Agency said to him, and probably the dad too, although he's not talking. Look, 53 years later, we thought we had the JFK assassination put to bed, and all of a sudden, here's the mainstream media looking at it again in detail. I would add, you know, the same stuff that District Attorney of New Orleans Garrison, Jim Garrison, was looking at. And I understand they basically said, look, you know, leave this race.
Well, Stone says he's talked to some of the other folks that knew Oswald, and that they've said, no, we knew Ted Cruz's dad. He was all part of the crew.
Yeah, and isn't it funny why Rafael Cruz, the dad, never responded directly? Because, you know, if he withheld...
Hold on, stay there. Yeah, I mean, if somebody's saying something true, you respond, don't you? We'll be right back. Stay with us. It was a month ago that our guest, Wayne Manson, first wrote about research and connections to Ted Cruz's father and the CIA and Lee Harvey Oswald. Since then, it's been in hundreds of newspapers, dozens and dozens, just dealing with the Roger Stone interview here yesterday. Stone's going to be back on, by the way, tomorrow. This is a short segment, long segment's coming up. Wayne, getting back into this and then also expanding into the campaign and current developments.
Yeah, so let's take this Rafael Cruz's dad, Ted Cruz's dad. If he came out and denied himself that was him with Oswald, and if he denied he had any association with Oswald, because I've also reported, you can look at the interlocking relationships between Cruz's employer, which was his own company, then purchased by Schlumberger Oil Services Company, and Permandex, which was the company owned by Clay Shaw, who was indicted by District Attorney Garrison for conspiracy to kill President Kennedy. If it later turned out that all this was verified, guess what he would have just done? He would have proved that he was evading in a capital crime, and that's murder. Any DA could get standing to indict him either in Texas or Louisiana. And the fact that he may have left for Calgary in 1967 to avoid Jim Garrison's subpoena to testify makes it a federal crime, because he crossed international borders, and that's where the FBI comes in. I'm not saying anything like this would happen, but he was certainly leaving.
Well, I know this. I mean, look, you come out and say this a month ago, it gets some traction. I can see him still not responding. But once it was Donald Trump saying it for weeks and it being a huge story, why didn't he come out and just say, see, these kooks are nuts. This is wrong.
I bet after he talked to his son, Ted, he talked to his attorney, and his attorney said, you best not say anything. That's my advice, because anything you say that's proven wrong, you're liable for criminal prosecution.
Well, listen, when you hear crickets on something like this, if you were wrong, and you're not saying this is what happened, you just said it, there's some evidence we should look at. There's something going on over here. Maybe nothing. The sun came up this morning. Maybe nothing either. And then now, nothing but crickets. That really tells us something.
Yeah, and this afternoon, I'll be sending two FOIA requests off to the Central Intelligence Agency asking for all correspondence, all information, all documents on both Rafael B. Cruz Jr., that's the father, but also Rafael B. Cruz Sr., the grandfather who worked for Radio Corporation of America, RCA, in Cuba, a well-known U.S. intelligence conduit in the early 50s. So I'm asking on everything they have on both the father and the grandfather, from the time the CIA was created in 1947 to the present time, to include any correspondence within the last couple of weeks because of the Donald Trump.
Well, that's newsmaking. Investigative journalist files Freedom of Information Act request on Cruz family CIA ties. That's pretty important.
Yeah, of course, I've got all kinds of pending FOIA requests out to various agencies. And of course, you know, now they don't feel like they even have to respond. They're getting away with violating the Freedom of Information Act of 1966 as amended over the years, because they know they can get away with it. So I'll be lucky to get any kind of response.
Let me shift gears out of that in the 2 minutes we've got until we got a break and come back in a long segment. What's the battle space right now? How are things going for the Soros, the Clinton camps, and others? Looks to me like all over the world, stuff's not going too well.
Yeah, you know, Donald Trump now has a very critical decision to make on who he runs with. Remember what Ronald Reagan never wanted to pick George H.W. Bush as his running mate. He didn't like him. He didn't like the Rockefeller Trilateral Commission elites that he was associated with. And you know what, 10 years, I mean, it's 10 weeks after he was inaugurated in 1981, a family friend of the Bush family takes a shot at him, almost kills him. And I would really caution Mr. Trump to be very, very careful who he picks. There's rumors about Newt Gingrich. Look, Newt Gingrich, he's owned and operated by Sheldon Adelson, who funded his last campaign for president in 2012. There's talk about some others.
Sure, they've had Gingrich from the start, right up next to him playing nice. That's their inside guy. I hope Trump is smart enough not to pull that move.
Yeah, he would do well to avoid these political insiders and go for somebody outside of Washington, perhaps with you know, executive governor experience. And there's a wealth of Republican governors who fairly kept their nose clean. Certainly not people.
What do you think about him? Like a war hero, a general, or something? Not good.
He needs to get somebody with some government experience. And like I say, there's an ample number of those who are, you know, have good ratings.
Well, stay there. Give us your astute observations, Wayne. Stay with us. I tell you, folks, there is so much going on in this world, so much unfolding, so much happening. I'm your host, Alex Jones. I've studied history. I'm not a rocket science major, but you can clearly see we're going into a very decadent cycle right now. The elites are so arrogant, they believe that voting doesn't even exist. They think they can steal our pension funds, raid our bank accounts, bring in foreigners to be balkanization counterweights to us and play us off against each other. I'm not against these other humans, but I'm against the brainwashing they've been under and how they're being set up as an enemy, how they're being set up as a deindustrializer, how they're being set up to destroy the very fragile remnants of a middle class we have that is a stairway for the poor into wealth. We're going into the Agenda 21 post-industrial system based on poverty, based on control, based on global elites and combines that are tax-exempt and above the law, the ultimate form of discrimination. And that's why I'm here fighting as hard as I can with other great researchers and journalists and just folks that are pro-human and believe in a level playing field and believe in industry and free will and free market and free association of every race, color, creed, region, religion, whatever. As long as you want basic freedom, I stand for you and with you. The problem is there's a lot of folks in the establishment and a lot of people in the grassroots that believe in government and success by conquest. And that always degenerates and implodes. We're going back to Wayne Madsen, WayneMadsenReport.com here in just a moment. He's going to be in Cleveland covering that wild event in July with us. He, of course, files reports daily at Infowars.com. He also writes at WayneMadsenReport.com. I want to ask him about all the preparations for destabilization, other big news he's working on, other items that he's focused on, the economy, and take some of your questions or comments on this Thursday edition. Quick question, quick comment is all we have time for in this hour before the next host comes in and hosts that fourth hour. So we got a fresh horse in there with all the latest breaking news and information. But I personally am getting more storable food. I personally am getting my emergency supplies in order because the elites have never been so active getting prepared. Is it for economic collapse? Is it for plan-triggered riots around the world? What are the 5 million Muslims being brought into Europe for the last 3 years? Many of them sleeper cells. What is the big plan they're gearing up for? Or is it a group of overlapping plans? That said, we've got the best high-quality storable foods out there at InfoWarsStore.com. 30 to 40% off. That special will end. I've extended it next Sunday in about 3 days. Take advantage of that. All other survival items from nutraceuticals like X2 and DNA Force and Anthroplex and Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver and Lung Cleanse and the Liver Shield and all the rest of it is 10% off and 10% off when you sign up for AutoShip on top of that and free shipping on orders above $50 and a bunch of other specials. Check them out for yourself at InfoWarsStore.com. Or simply by calling toll-free, we can answer all your questions, send you a free catalog, 888 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And that's how we also fund our operation, so it's a win-win across the board. Thank you all for your free association and your support. God bless you. You don't stand behind us. You stand right beside us and at the heart of what we're doing. Wayne, I don't know your view on this, so I want to find out now. I mean, clearly, I mean, you know about the stuff going on in the world. Why are elites running around digging into redoubts, moving to New Zealand, saying get ready for collapse, moving armored vehicles around, buying massive amounts of riot control gear? I mean, it's all over the news. Billions of rounds, more of bullets, saying the Patriots are their enemy, Europe arresting nationalist party members that aren't racist at all, but even if they were racist, shouldn't be arrested, you know, free speech. What are the preparations for? What do you think the establishment's tricks are up their sleeves? And obviously there are different camps of the establishment. How does it all tie into the failed bid to overthrow Syria? What's happening with Russia? Kind of a big picture look of where the world is, because the Pentagon says we've never been in a more dangerous position. I tend to agree. Obama says the economy's never been better and the world is absolutely stable and wonderful and the moon is made of Swiss cheese.
Well, I think what they're concerned about is what happened in this country with Donald Trump basically overthrowing the Republican establishment and Bernie Sanders attempting to overthrow, with some success, the Democratic establishment. That coupled with Boris Johnson, who's pushing against the Britain remaining in the EU, and if they vote to exit the EU, that's the end of Cameron, and that's the beginning of a Boris Johnson prime ministership. The Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership is dead because the French have basically said, nothing doing, we're pulling out.
Incredible.
And so look, all these constructs, the Trans-Pacific Partnership is in trouble. The Prime Minister of Japan said, oh, we're not gonna do anything on that until after our elections because his popularity is plummeting because of that. The world is waking up to these trade agreements and this attempt to whittle away at national sovereignty. And who was the first leader to say, I don't want to have anything to do with this stuff, was Vladimir Putin in Russia. And
absolutely. You know, let me just interrupt you, because what you're saying is so historic, so cogent. That's why Wayne Madsen is so amazing. He just boiled it all down, because I'm thinking of all these different angles. He says, look, global government's in trouble. Unelected corporate world government is on the run everywhere. They went too far. It's imploding, on the verge of collapse. And so they're openly saying, let's get ready to take over the media, internet regional kill switches, Zuckerberg meeting with the communist Chinese admitting that, beta testing it, getting ready to try to jump, you know, off the cliff here with us, off the high dive, as if they'll get away with it. You guys couldn't even get away with stealing the election. I think they're desperate, as you just said, undoubtedly, and they've miscalculated, but so many times historically, megalomaniacs go all the way when cornered. That's my concern. So A, what do you think they'll do? Flesh it out more. Great points you just made. And B, what happens if they go ahead and double down and go crazy? What could that meltdown look like? And of course, I should give the number out. 800-259-9231 to talk to Wayne Madsen. Got to give the number out. Thanks for reminding me, John. 800-259-9231. Wayne, please continue with that incredible analysis.
Well, I'll tell you, look, I mean, they can't rig enough elections now because too many people are voting against the status quo. And, you know, they'll try in the UK. Look, Obama was over there basically interfering in now two of their elections, the referendum on Scottish independence. He said it's better for Scotland to stay in the UK. And now he recently went over there and said it's best for the UK to stay in the EU. Well, people in Scotland don't want to be part of the UK, and the people in the UK don't want to be part of the EU, but he's over there because he represents.
So time is on our side, even though they block Catalonia, who voted like 90%. They say, no, you can't. Well, yeah, they are. I mean, almost every person's against it. Bye-bye. And then absolutely Scotland, like 70% were against it, still didn't pass. So you're kind of predicting the Brexit will be a fraud as well.
What I'm being told is, at this point in time, if that's a fair election over there, the British electorate will vote to leave the European Union, and then it's curtains for that organization, because there's other countries waiting to leave too. Primarily Austria, Greece already got a taste of that. They can get rid of their Soros influenced government.
Well, so what's the next domino to fall once that happens?
I think we'll see the EU come to an end. I think we'll see the end of the open borders. Essentially, that's already happened with Merkel's invasion by these Muslim refugees of Europe. And also coming in with that crowd is a bunch of Islamic State terrorists. And this is where I say, you know, Trump really has to be careful who he picks as his vice president. Right now, I would say he should pick a woman, a governor, or maybe an ex-governor. And Mary Phelan of Oklahoma is very high on his list. And former Governor Jan Brewer of Arizona is high on his list because Hillary is going to use all that stuff.
That's right. If he doesn't pick a woman, he's stupid. And I don't think he's stupid. If he doesn't pick a good one, there are a lot of great candidates, a lot of qualified women. If he doesn't, it really shows that he's a ringer, which I don't think Trump is.
Right. He could pick Christie, but the problem there is it's not like Clinton picking Al Gore, neighboring states, Arkansas, Tennessee. Al Gore spent very little time in Tennessee. He grew up in D.C. Christie's right across the Hudson River in New Jersey. That's not a geographical balance. He needs geographical balance. Oklahoma and Arizona would provide that, especially in Arizona with its issue with the border, would be very, very good for him. I mean, if I were advising him, I'd say look at Phelan or look at Brewer, that's up to him.
Great points. Getting back to Putin and then some phone calls, 800-259-9231, folks. Your chance to talk to Wayne Madsen, just a few of those calls coming up. Say what you want about Putin, but it's kind of like Trump said. He said, oh, he's killed people? Show me the proof. They just say that. And then 9 times out of 10, it turns out to be some globalist foundation killing somebody and doing a false flag. The truth is, Putin said carbon tax is a global government fraud. We're not going to teach people to break down the family. We're going to cut taxes. He's going after corruption in all their states. And he's very, very popular, 80%+. So they've got a major problem on their hands. He's the opposite of a dictator. He's superstar popular, and he's criticizing the corrupt, elites, the oligarchs that have seized us. That's basically what Trump is doing, and it scares the daylights out of them. So, wow, what happens to the New World Order if Trump turns out to win and is for real? And you're going to see major power structures trying to stir up a new fight.
Yeah, if you could foresee a Trump administration, Prime Minister Boris Johnson in Britain, and Putin remaining in Russia, you're going to see a different world entirely. All these international structures that whittle away at national sovereignty are going to come to an end. I think NATO will be, people wake up and realize that that's nothing more than a contrivance to get European countries to buy weapons, expensive weapon systems from the United States. That's why it exists. And as far as, you know, Russian aircraft doing barrel rolls over U.S. spy planes, well, what do you expect when you got a series of U.S. spy planes flying near the Kaliningrad Russian naval base in the Baltic? All they're doing are getting close to see, watch the Russians fire up their radar. These are called ferret missions, so they can collect all the electronic intelligence and communications and then try to break the encryption codes. Of course the Russians are going to react negatively to that, just as we would if Russian planes flew off of Norfolk, Virginia, or off of San Diego, California.
Yeah, can you imagine if Russian jets were flying like 5 miles off the U.S. coast, what would happen? Complete connection fits.
We'd be doing more than barrel rolls on them. We'd be shooting them down. Yeah.
And well, Trump thinks he's weak on being too friendly to the Russians, so he's made this comment about, yeah, if they don't do what we say, shoot them down. So I hope the Russians know that is rhetoric.
Yeah, and he also said he can get along with Putin, and Putin has indicated he could get along with the President Trump. As far as China, you know, we've heard various things. Trump says I love the Chinese. He's going to be a lot harder on the trade issues with them, but I don't think he's going to be rattling sabers by sending U.S. Navy ships into the South China Sea. You know, the South China Sea, China's in that name of that thing, and ancient Chinese maps show that those islands were historically part of China. So I think he'll recognize that fact and stop encouraging countries like the Philippines and Vietnam and other countries over there to try to, you know, ratchet things up.
Sure, the West is clearly using Vietnam as a chess piece against China, not defending the communist murderers. It's just that it's totally sickening to see them trying to stir all this up. I want to go to some phone calls for Wayne Madsen. We got George and Jeff and Dwight and Bill and Jason. Let's go ahead and take a call from Jeff in Canada. You're on the air with Wayne Madsen. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Alex. We are winning, whether Trump gets in the White House or not. Trump has definitely set the pace, and we need to continue and accelerate that pace. Wayne, a question for you. It's just a two-part. It's very simple. When do you foresee the FBI taking their investigation a little bit further with Hillary? Do you foresee the FBI doing anything before?
Yeah, what's the word on that, before the election? Because, I mean, she's caught red-handed, and then still they keep saying, well, the Justice Department needs to do it. Well, that's Hillary. That's Obama.
Well, I don't see the FBI doing anything. What a federal judge in D.C. ruled was that the group Judicial Watch will be able to depose Hillary Clinton and all of her aides, Huma Abedin and others, in this email issue. I don't see Comey, the FBI director, doing it. He's a political creature. The FBI is not a law enforcement agency. It's a political police force. They'll take action when the administration wants them to. And when the Obama administration doesn't want action taken against their former Secretary of State and the presumptive Democratic nominee, I don't think they're going to take any.
Well, I agree, but it does discredit these institutions even more when they sit there and do nothing when she's completely guilty.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I've had the FBI visiting me recently. Well, actually, over the last year or so, year and a half. And, you know, they asked me about this. And I said, look, if you're after Chinese spies, go up to the National Archives where they're making copies of all the U.S. patents. You know, don't come here and, you know, lean on me for information. But, you know, they're a political police force.
You never told it. I mean, I know you've been visited by a lot of folks and threatened, too. Let's thank you, caller. Good question, Jeff. Tell us about the FBI visit.
Yeah, I mean, I made a trip to Iran a year and a half ago. I was invited to attend a conference there. I thought it was a good conference. I had never been there before. I managed to gain access to the old U.S. embassy, which is almost like it was when it was taken hostage. So that engendered a couple of visits. And then because I... have been to China. I went to China in 2012. That was another visit. And, you know, they're...
Now, were they wanting info from you or trying to imply you were a bad guy?
I think both. You know, it's good cop, bad cop. And look, the FBI was set up by J. Edgar Hoover as a intelligence gathering operation. It never had anything to do
with... Well, sure. I mean, until the 50s, they said organized crime didn't exist.
Yeah, because Meyer Lansky had the photo of J. Edgar Hoover in flagrante delicto with his deputy, Clyde Tolson, at the Fontainebleau Hotel in Miami. And they have that building in Washington named after. They're going to move out of that building. I understand the new FBI building won't be named after J. Edgar.
Sure. Look. J. Edgar Hoover was always on the mob payroll. It's just crazy.
Yeah, I call him J. We call him J. Edna Hoover. But, you know,
it's not a big deal that he was a cross-dresser. That's his right to do that.
Exactly.
It's just they use that to blackmail him. Absolutely. I mean, look, he was the Caitlyn Jenner of his time. I mean, you know, look what they built on it—an amazing, amazing career shipping drugs into the country. All right, folks, we'll be right back. Final segment, more phone calls, and two more segments with Wayne Madsen. We got the next host coming in, but Sherry and George, everybody, stay there. Make no mistake, it's an incredible time to be alive. Huge changes are happening. The social engineers know that. They're trying to act like only they have power, only they can direct humanity. And if they can get us to not say mother and father, or he or she, or stewardess, or mailman, or whatever, next they can tell us what other words we can use. And that's where they're going. They're going to pure totalitarianism, but it's not working. It's blowing up in their face big time. Let's go ahead and talk to George in Connecticut. George, you're on the air with Wayne Madsen. Go ahead.
Hi there. I'm wondering, once we get everything sort of squared away for Trump and moving in the right direction, and we know there's not much of a chance of backsliding, I think we should move on to Bilderberg or as a major a focus, and maybe hook up with some of the people in Europe that basically have been against this anti-immigration stuff, that with the Muslims in particular, especially in Dresden.
It's a Bilderberg member, Peter Sutherland and others, that engineered opening the borders, merging all the countries together and destroying sovereignty using incompatible groups. Absolutely. Wayne Madsen?
A lot of simpatico groups in Europe that, distrust these groups like Bilderbergs. You find them on the right and on the left. The ones in the center, that's where they get their support. And they, you know, the so-called social democrats and Christian democrats, there's not a whole lot of difference between them. They're all controlled by people like Soros and the other people behind the scenes.
Sure. All right, George, anything else?
One other thing is that since the leader of Pegida, however you pronounce it correctly, is right there in Dresden, so he'd be a good person to coordinate this if we ever got something going there.
That's a good idea. We should talk to some of the folks over there about when we go to Germany to cover their events and things. Great idea, sir. Thank you. Speaking of Europe, let's go to France. Let's talk to Sherry in France. Sherry, you're on the air with Wayne Madsen. Go ahead.
Oh, hi to Wayne and to you. I'm calling about the vice presidential pick, and there is mention of maybe someone with a military experience, but from what you've said, Wayne, it would be better someone who has governmental experience. And I was thinking about what do you think of Susana Martinez, the Hispanic governor from New Mexico? Because Gingrich brought her up, and he seemed to think that would be a good idea, and I don't know if it is. Do you know, can you tell us more about Susana Martinez? Do you know?
I think Susana Martinez would be an excellent choice. There's only one problem, and it would be used against the ticket if he chooses her. She had a very well-publicized incident with public drunkenness in New Mexico, basically was ordering her driver to take her back to her residence. Look, it's stuff like that is going to be magnified 100 times. Why not go with somebody with a relatively clean record and not somebody who had a well-publicized problem with alcohol?
Well, I'm always impressed by how informed our listeners and our guests are. Thank you, Sherry. Anything else from France?
Just a question. Another question is, if anything should happen to Trump, then he'd need to pick someone who really has the America First in mind.
That's a great point. That's what Wayne's been saying, Wayne.
I think based on the fact that Mary Fallon has been governor for a while, she's handled a lot of emergencies, state emergencies. Jan Brewer on the border with Mexico. I think either one of those could be the first.
No, you're right. I'm not for gimmicks, but if these are good, smart women who have good records and seem like pretty trustworthy, avarice-filled people like some of these other guys, I think it's great to counter her gimmick with a woman, but not make it a gimmick. Actually a good person. We'll be back with 5 more minutes of Wayne. Then the next host comes in with a bunch of breaking news. So much at InfoWars.com. Get those articles and videos out, folks. You are the power. There's 4 minutes left, and then Rob Dew's coming in to quarterback the rest of the hour. Here's some of the headlines why folks hate Trump so much in the establishment. Trump wants to help U.S. businesses by lifting a slew of regulations. CNBC. But this other report out of Reuters as well, U.S. jobless claims rise, planned layoffs surge. So one concern I have, Wayne, I want to take a few calls, is Trump gets in, they hold the collapse in the West off until he gets in and then kind of blame nationalism rising in Europe with a more nationalist conservative, or not even conservative, just common sense person in Austria getting elected. What's your take on that?
Yeah, well, he's going to have a tough time as president because he's going to have a very hostile Democratic Party in the Congress and a hostile Republican Party for the most part in Congress. And, you know, Ross Perot, had he been elected in 1992, would have had the very same problem. He's going to have to be able to finesse like no other president has before because he's going to have, essentially, he's going to have two opposition parties in the Congress. His own Republican Party.
Isn't his answer go right to the American people day one and say, look, it's the establishment again, a bunch of arrogant parties. They've taken control. Help me.
Well, Obama's done that. He's going around the White House press corps to directly the American people. And, that's one thing Trump can borrow from Obama. I'd say probably the only thing he ought to is how he can bypass the media to go directly to the people. But it's going to be very, very difficult. He's going to have to be also, I mentioned the VP thing, he's going to have to be very selective in who he picks for his cabinet, because that's sure. where he can probably bring in people who can work with a hostile Congress.
That's right. Let's talk to Dwight in Washington and Mel in Costa Rica. Dwight, you're on the air with Wayne Madsen.
Yes, I was wondering about if those cruise ships going back and forth to Cuba might possibly at some point be used to bring Cuban soldiers over, and also if it was even possible for Cynthia McKinney to be vice president since she's not a Republican.
Sure, sure. But here's, I don't really think the Cubans are going to invade us, folks. The globalists are going to invade us with cheap labor and drive our cost of living down. Some of our guests have said that, and it's globalization of our police and military to begin with. That's how they take over. But as for Cynthia McKinney, you know, she's a really great lady, and she's liking Donald Trump. You know, all these real people on the left like Trump. They see what's happening.
Yeah, Cynthia's a friend of mine. She's been for many years, and I think she'd be an excellent VP pick. But I think, right now we see the Republican money people are going to be in there. I think Cynthia, barring a VP pick, which I don't think Trump is going to do, would be a very good Secretary of State.
Well, talking about Ron Paul in there in the Treasury of the Secretary of State, that'd be wild.
Absolutely. I mean, Treasury, Ron Paul, I think Rand Paul would be more effective in the Senate as somebody that can help Trump there. He's going to need all the friends he can get.
I agree. Let's real fast. Mel in Costa Rica, real quick question for Wayne. Go ahead.
Yes, Wayne, do you think there'll be some attempts on his life during the campaign or during maybe if once he gets elected?
Yeah, what's the danger zone? Is it more now or more later? Thank you. Great point, Mel.
I'll tell you, the danger thing for me was when he was in a debate in Houston and old man Bush, Poppy 41, was sitting in the audience and he did this, thing across the neck. The guy's halfway senile, but I don't think that was an act of senility. I think he was showing his true colors. But Trump's got to be very, very careful, especially since that my source on the Marco Rubio photos, Gary Welsh, an attorney and blogger in Indianapolis, said
hold on, Wayne, himself. Hold on. If you can do it, I'm punching out. But I want to have you do 5 more minutes with Rob Due to talk about your source. I forgot in Indianapolis, found dead a few days ago in a stairwell. That is huge. Stay there, Wayne.
All right, it's the fourth hour of Overdrive. I'm your host, Rob Due, sitting in for, I guess, Anthony Gucciardi. And we got Wayne Madsen on the line. We're going to go back to him in 1 second. I want to tell you a little bit about what I have coming up. We just had the article on Infowars.com how Cinco de Mayo, I guess, revelers were smashing Trump pinatas in the name of, ending racism or something like that. We're going to go, we got a really interesting story out of Oakland, California. I'm going to have Joe Biggs in to pop. He sent this to me, but he's also going to be in because we're sending him and Darren McBreen out to Eugene, Oregon. There's going to be a Trump rally there. And already there are over nearly 600 people that are going to go to that protest, the anti-Trump protest movement. It's still just because Trump won the nomination or is the presumptive nominee at this point doesn't mean people are going to stop protesting. And it really is where you get the true agenda of these people that are afraid of free speech and afraid of any idea that counters their idea of a socialist collective. So let's go back to Wayne Madsen right now. We have this article from Kit Daniels on May 3rd, Indiana voting fraud activist behind Rubio's sex party leaks found dead. And his name is Gary Welsh. He was found at the bottom of a stairwell in his apartment complex. Wayne, have there been any new developments on this since the May 3rd article?
Well, there was supposed to have been an autopsy done on Monday. I don't believe that we've seen any report on the outcome of that. Gary Welsh's service is this afternoon in Terre Haute, Indiana. But this one defies logic. Why? Because the police determined based on a final blog entry he made saying, I may not be around Tuesday when Trump wins Indiana, but I think he's going to come in just under 50%. In fact, he came in at 53%. The police figured out that was some sort of indication that he planned to commit suicide. Well, if fearful of your life because you may be getting death threats. If that's any indication of suicide, then, you know, Martin Luther King made that prophetic speech too. I may not get there with you. I've been to the mountaintop. Well, you know, shortly after that, he was assassinated. So, you know, it's just basic, simple police work that just because somebody says I might not be around much longer, you should also take into consideration that his life was being threatened. The other thing is, Gary was also advancing the Ted Cruz story with his dad in New Orleans and Oswald. And he was also an attorney who specialized in election law. He had been before the Indiana Electoral Commission on more than one occasion to argue about, you know, election irregularities. And the mere fact that he dies right before the Indiana primary, I think is very, very suspicious.
Yeah, I would agree. And, you know, other people you've talked to, Wayne, the D.C. madam, she had the names and numbers of people who went to her her sex service. And she comes on the Alex Jones show, says she has some great information she wants to give Alex, but she didn't want to give it over the air. He didn't take it.
Yeah.
And then a few days later, she winds up, you know, hung in her mom's woodshed out in the back. I mean,
yeah, and I was in email communication with Gary Webb for a few months before they said he shot himself twice in the head. And ironically, we were both looking at a company called Affiliated Computer Systems myself because they had approved the visas for those Arab alleged hijackers on 9/11. And he was looking at them for some fraud in Sacramento. But Affiliated Computer Systems had as their vice president Stephen Goldsmith, a former mayor of Ware, Indianapolis, Indiana. I think it's very ironic that here again we have a suspicious suicide in Indianapolis, let alone Indiana. And I would also add that the news just broke that an attorney for WikiLeaks is said to have just jumped in front of a commuter train in England, and of course he was killed.
Wow. Yeah, jumped or pushed. I mean, depending on.
Oh, I'm sure he was. Yeah, in cases like that, you're usually pushed.
Yeah.
And well, not to get graphic, but autopsies don't work real well after something like that.
That's true. That is one way of covering up any evidence, and especially if you got knocked on the head or something. And they found, I think, two young boys down in where you guys were at, down in and near Mexico and the Texas border. They were. Or it was a husband and wife that were found dead, and they saw, they think they saw a drug deal or something, and then they were placed on the tracks.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of weird goings on. And anytime you want to put out information that is against the globalist cabal, Barry Jennings, another fine example. Here's a guy who breaks the silence, talks about explosions that were happening in the base or the ground level in the lobby of World Trade Center 7 before it collapsed, before the towers had even collapsed. There was people in there dead. He was walking over dead bodies. And then shortly after that, he gets fast-acting leukemia and meets his demise as well. So anytime people are bringing out information, and you know it's hot if they end up dead shortly thereafter.
Well, the first two stories I ever investigated were investigative journalist Danny Casolaro was on to old man Bush and Mina and all that stuff, Clinton too. It was on to Clinton, and they said he slashed his wrists 12 times, each wrist, in the bathtub of a hotel in Martinsburg, West Virginia. They called that suicide. And also Vince Foster was the second one I investigated, and they called that suicide. Of course, it was well known he had been carrying on an affair with Hillary Clinton before that.
Please don't say that. You're putting bad thoughts in my head.
Well, she goes both ways. Although I think she goes only one way now in the last probably decade and a half.
Can you imagine how big is the Clinton body count going to grow if she gets back into office? I mean, it's come out that I got to find the article that they've known about the Guccifer email hacks for years. Or NBC. Why did NBC sit on explosive news story about Clinton's alleged hacked email server for weeks? Well, that's to protect her. And they don't want that information out too early. Right. Unless they're thinking of deep sixing her at some point in the nomination process and bringing in somebody else. You know, because they don't want Bernie, so maybe they bring in Joe Biden at the end, and he would ride in on a white horse and rescue the Democratic Party.
Right. Well, NBC take, and like all the networks take their orders from either the CIA or the Pentagon. That's part of the continuing Operation Mockingbird that never went away.
Yeah, and Guccifer's now here. They've extradited him here to the United States. He was in a Romanian prison for a while, and now he's here. So who knows what he is saying? Hopefully, he stays safe.
Yeah, we hope so. But if he's, being a guest of the Justice Department and Bureau of Prisons, anything is possible.
Sure. Yeah. After he spills his guts or sings, and then they, do whatever they do in prison. But let's hope that doesn't happen to him. Anything else, Wayne, before you go?
I think this cruise story is still generating a lot of interest. A lot of JFK assassination experts are weighing in on both sides, saying it's a nonsense story. I'm being attacked by a few of them. But I'm also hearing from those JFK researchers who say, yeah, we never could identify who that guy was. And it looks like it could be, in fact, Rafael Cruz.
Do you think that's why he punched his wife and elbowed her as he was hugging his dad? Maybe it was just some sort of way he was so mad that he dropped out of the race. And, maybe dad asked him to drop out.
Yeah, Carly Fiorina, she fell off the stage and he didn't even try to help her. And then he hits his wife Heidi with his elbow three times. So, yeah, maybe he's reacting very negatively to being told to pick up your building blocks and your Tinker Toy set and, just go home.
Yeah, we got to protect daddy and his CIA cover. And
absolutely.
If that's what really happened, we don't know. But if anyone's going to get to the bottom of it, it'll be Wayne Madsen. So thanks for working with us, Wayne, and we'll see you soon. You're going to be joining us at the RNC. Oh, there yes. It is. Ow. Well, it looks like it hurts. We just showed that on TV of the of Cruz elbowing his wife in the face after he succumbed to defeat from the mighty Trump. So thanks for joining us, Wayne.
You bet.
And you can read more about that Indiana voting fraud activist behind Rubio's sex party leaks found dead. Right there on Infowars.com. It's a Kit Daniels article from May 3rd. And then you could go back and walk the links back and read the other stories. Wayne Madsen put out a story about it as well a while back. And that's the thing about Infowars. We're breaking these stories, and it takes a while for them to enter the mainstream media. But sometimes it takes a month. Sometimes it takes a week. Sometimes it takes 2 years. But eventually, they do make it out there. So what's going on at the border right now? Well, it is Cinco de Mayo, so I guess it is appropriate to talk about the border. Here's from North Carolina News, NC man among some joining groups in U.S. to patrol border with Mexico. And talk about this 2,000-mile border spanning, and people are coming from all over the world. This is a man named Doc who decided to take his vacation time and be part of the solution, I guess, watching the border. He says they come through and they cut the barbed wire. Literally takes seconds to get on our side of the border with packs and mules and things like that. It's basically not even a deterrent. It only holds them up for a few seconds. And they're talking about the fence. And in some places, it doesn't even exist. As Joe Biggs has shown others, how he just walks over into Mexico and can walk back and nobody stops him. He crossed the border dressed as an ISIS terrorist at one point, and nothing's being done. We've shot video of the gates just being left open right there at the border, where they do have a fence and somewhat of a deterrent along El Paso, but then that quickly dies off as soon as you move. So we're going to have more news coming up. David Knight's going to come in next, and we're going to talk about TTIP and why it looks like it's going to fail in, especially the European countries are pissed off. They don't want it because now we get to see what's in the plan, and now we go, wait a minute, that's why it's been negotiated in secret. This has been Rob Dew with Infowars.com. You're watching The Fourth Hour, Infowars.com/show for all the live feeds. Welcome back to The Fourth Hour. I'm your host, Rob Dew. Sitting next to me is David Knight, and he's got some news on TTIP and also some Hillary news. And I just want to cover this real quick. Going back to this NBC story, why did it sit on an explosive story about Clinton's alleged hacked email server for weeks? So they have a transcript here with Cynthia McFadden talking to Guccifer, and she's talking about the Hillary server being absolutely safe, and he starts laughing. He says, that's a lie. And this is the guy
who's not a computer programmer.
Exactly. You're right. Lazar is openly admitting to hacking her private email account, the same private email account where federal officials found over 2,000 emails that contained classified information and at least 22 deemed top secret.
Well, you know, 22. That's not too bad, huh?
So if it's a lie, Rob, why is he in prison?
Exactly. And, you know, the Clinton campaign noted that. They said there's absolutely no basis to believe the claims made by this criminal from his prison cell.
Free Guccifer. That needs to be the new T-shirt.
That's where she's going to be soon if the FBI actually gets to do a real investigation. So, but you didn't even come in here to talk about that, although that's, you know, kind of hot in the news.
Yeah.
TTIP is in the news as well. I guess France has said they don't want to go along with it. They're pissed off because people are finally getting to read the plan.
That's right. And to get everybody up to speed, if you haven't heard this, of course, there's two big treaties that have been negotiated in secret by multinational corporations. Our lawmakers are not allowed to see them. Eventually, when they were, nobody cared except for Jeff Sessions, who's been the only senator to read this, to talk about it. And, of course, the only person he's ever endorsed is Donald Trump. As we're looking at this now, this was leaked by Greenpeace Netherlands. So they published this on Tuesday, and it has really set the people in Europe on fire about this. They say that besides the secrecy on it, they say it's going to affect human health, labor rights, internet privacy rights, the very social fabric of Europe itself. Of course, it's a massive deal. This is about sovereignty. It's about managing your economy, and it's about the internet. It's about privacy. It's about everything, okay? This is the whole ball of wax, and we've got two of these creatures. We've got the TPP, which is the Trans-Pacific Partnership. These are treaties, folks. They're not partnerships. But also the transatlantic. This is the transatlantic partnership. And, of course, in France, the socialist there, Hollande, says absolutely not. It questions the essential principles for our agriculture, our culture, our reciprocity of access to public markets. He says it's unacceptable. And he says it would make no sense to have this climate deal in December because this is going to unravel some of it. And Hillary Clinton is saying the same things, too. So now they're saying, oh, we can't do this because of the climate deal. And that points up the fact that there are two ways for them to do global consolidation, destruction of our economy, and setting up their own crony capitalist
Is one of the conditions to allow Monsanto to grow GM crops in Europe, or is that off the table?
I don't know that specificity of it, but that has been part of it, is that the Americans have been pushing to make sure that there's no regulations that are going to stop GMO production. Right. And so I imagine that is in the very last thing. When we look at what's happening in America, I think it's also interesting. Hillary Clinton's been campaigning in West Virginia because they're going to have a primary on Tuesday. It looks like Bernie Sanders is going to really slaughter her there.
Oh, I think so.
Yeah.
With her comments on coal.
Absolutely. And her ties into the Obama administration.
Right.
Because Obama said coming in, he's going to make sure he had a war on coal. We've talked about that many times. If you build a coal factory, a coal mine, it's going to bankrupt you.
Yeah.
Power plant.
He said, right. Yeah, he actually came out and said, we're going to go bankrupt.
But he went after the power plants. But, of course, he's also going after the coal mines because if nobody's going to burn it in the power plants, it's going to shut them down. There were 300 coal mines in West Virginia 5 years ago. Today, there's less than 70. That's 80% of them gone in 5 years. It's 10,000 jobs that have been lost. And there was an article from the Daily Caller today saying that the EPA's shutdown of coal is the equivalent to all of the electrical power generation in all the United Kingdom. So that's how much they're taking offline. We have
jack up power prices.
That's right.
Yeah.
To jack that up and also come in, they're going to offer them some green plans. We've seen how Solyndra works and all these crony capitalists. This is a massive transfer of power and wealth to their friends, okay?
And who don't really succeed.
That's right.
Even when they get these handouts, they still can't succeed.
And we've had a gut-wrenching piece that came out this week in exchange with a guy who was a coal miner. I want to play you a little clip of this. Let's roll that clip.
My future. I want my family to know that they have a future here in this state.
She said, and she did not make it a secret, that she is going to continue with the policies of the past 7.5 years and expand upon them. There's no other way to perceive that. Pure and simple, we are doomed.
It's an attack on a way of life, exactly. And we'll be back with, we're going to let David Knight finish up after this, and really tells you what kind of creature she is.
Yep.
She wants to live in her little castle and have everybody else underneath her, underlings. So we'll be right back. On the march. And read the
Bible by the coal oil light. We take pride in our faith in God. We take pride in our family. We take pride in our jobs. We take pride in the fact that we're hard workers. Raise that kid on a miner's pay.
really look at her record and what she's laid out in this campaign, she's the one that's really with coal miners and trying to help them not only get the benefits that they've earned, but the respect that they deserve.
Where were they for the last 7 years to step up and say, no, wait a minute, let's take a more reasonable approach to this? She's been part of the cabinet. I mean, this Obama administration has done everything they could, as he had promised, to put the coal business out of business. And it's really had a tremendous economic impact here in West Virginia.
And now that witch Hillary Clinton is trying to walk that back, saying, oh, no, I love coal miners. I want to give you guys some benefits.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, that's the amazing thing, Rob. She goes to West Virginia to campaign, and she brags about how we're going to put a lot of coal miners and coal companies out of business. And so there was this guy who asked her that very touch. It was a very touching exchange going back, and it really got to her. She didn't know how to respond to that. This is a guy who's 39 years old. He's working.
And that's what you hear in that story from Loretta Lynn. She said, we were poor, but our family, our daddy worked hard. He supported us. You know, it's...
And here's the bottom line to it, too. You may think this doesn't affect you living in a big city somewhere. Well, it's going to raise your power prices, and it's going to raise everybody's power prices. And what you get when you're paying more money for power, basic power, when it was cheap, it used to be pretty cheap, you're not going to have as much innovation. You want a country that's innovating and doing things, you have cheap power. Whether you like it or not, hey, we have nuclear power, too. I'm not for that, but it also produces electricity. And we need electricity to make things work.
That's wars in the Middle East because we are so dependent upon oil. Yeah. If we were had more coal, we have more coal than Saudis have oil, okay? Far more. And the bottom line is there's nothing other than nothing affects your standard of living, even your life expectancy, more than cheap energy, okay? You want to have a prosperous country. You want to have a long life expectancy, a high standard of living. You need cheap energy. We've got cheap energy. They're artificially making it expensive. So you got Obama coming in with his coal regulations, and you got 24 states who file suit against it. It goes to the Supreme Court in February. We got the New York Times headline, Supreme Court deals blow to Obama's efforts to regulate coal emissions. They put a stay on these emissions. They were going to go to a court in Washington, D.C., where Merrick Garland, who has now been tapped to be the Supreme Court nominee for Obama, is going to go to that court with the three judges. We're going to decide whether or not we're going to be allowed to burn coal in this country. I mean, that's a major problem.
How convenient that he's the one right there.
And so then Scalia dies. They expected they were going to say, yeah, okay, green light the EPA, because that's what Merrick Garland has done his entire career, is green light everything the bureaucracy want to do. They said it was going to lose 5-4 at the Supreme Court until Scalia died. Now the lower court decision will stand. The regulations from the EPA will stand. And when she's talking about the fact, we're going to make sure they get their benefits, we're going to give you some green jobs to do or whatever, it isn't going to happen.
You're going to recycle cans in the, you know, in the local supermarket or something.
Well, the lady who tried to walk this back said, look, we're going to make sure they get their benefits.
Yeah.
How has that worked out in Oregon?
Right.
Okay, when we went out there and we talked to the people, we talked to the miners, we talked to the loggers, we talked to the ranchers out there. When they go in and shut down the miners, when they shut down the loggers, they say, all right, we're not going to let you earn a living anymore taking out dead wood. And, of course, that makes the forests all burn down whenever they have a forest fire, because they leave the fuel in there. So it's good for the environment. It's good for the economy. It's good for everyone because we get cheaper wood. Okay, they take out the dead wood. But they say, we're not going to allow you to do that. But to ease the transition, we're going to give you welfare benefits for 10 years. Well, you know what? Those welfare benefits are finished.
Yeah.
And there's nothing left. They can't even fund the police department in these areas.
And what are they going to do?
Yeah.
You know, they're just going to move on, or that area will collapse.
Well, it's the reservation.
And then the feds will come in and say, well, now we own this too, because nobody's living here. So we're just going to take this and keep adding on.
It's the reservation. Look at Hillary Clinton's other comment where she said, I know how to deal with men who get off the reservation. Well, the Indians got rightfully upset about that, because the reservation, as Russell Means has pointed out, has been a horrific instrument to oppress Indians since it was done 100 years ago, 150 years ago, okay? And what they did was they created a gulag, a socialist gulag for these people, and constrained them where they could not earn a living, where they were completely dependent upon the government. And now that's what they're doing to everybody, okay? They talk about, she said, well, I was talking about Rudy Giuliani, not my husband, okay? They can go back and forth about that, but look, they want to put everybody on a reservation. They want all of us
to be shut down
and constrained into a confined area where we can't earn a living and we're dependent on their benefits.
Exactly. And then you've got these people running around trying to kill what's left of America. And people, this lady should be in jail. She should be investigated right now. She shouldn't be running for president. But all this goes back to you have to be prepared. What if you lose your job? What if something strikes, like they're saying now, the San Andreas Fault is locked and loaded and ready to go? We were interviewing people out in South, in San Francisco, and this one, you know, triggly puff wannabe was sitting there yelling at a Trump supporter, "Oh, you one of those preppers?" Like it was bad to be prepared when they live in a freaking earthquake zone.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. She probably wasn't born when it happened during the World Series and destroyed bridges and people died and, you know, it was mass chaos for a few days. No, you have to stay prepared. And one way you could do that right now is we have a mega sale going 30 to 40% off of InfoWars select storable food. So it's got a 25 year shelf life. Food prices are going up. You think energy prices are going up? Food prices are going up too.
Oh yeah.
You know, they're hitting everybody where it hurts. This is all, and these, all the people that say the government's going to help you, government's going to help you. Hey, the government killed the Indians and put them on reservations. Yeah. That wasn't citizens going out and rounding up Indians. That was your big government that you like so much. Okay. Right. Your big government that destroys giant businesses that provide cheap power. So you live like a serf, you can't have a job, and then you can't pay for the power either because it's gone up so much because, oh, we're going to do these giant solar farms that aren't very efficient, that are stuck out in somewhere, and it's all collectivized instead of, you know, encouraging people to put solar in your home. That's one way to get out of the system a little bit.
Because they have to centralize everything.
Oh, they do.
That's why they want the big projects. They don't want you decentralized like that.
Exactly. So go to InfoWarsStore.com and check out our storable foods. And if you don't have a water filter at this point in your life, you are crazy. If you think Flint, Michigan is the only place that has bad water, you got another thing coming. You should get your water tested, and you should be filtering your water anyway, just especially if you have kids. You don't want these heavy metals and stuff that are in the water, all the pharmaceuticals. I mean, there's so much pharmaceuticals in the water now, they're turning the frogs from male to female. I mean, there's a lot going on.
We just got a notification, Rob, from North Carolina, where we used to live, saying, you know, hey, the water's going to look really bad. It's going to smell really bad. But don't worry. It's just cosmetic.
Yeah, it's okay.
Otherwise, it's safe to drink it. And it's like, yeah, right. You know, and the worst part is when they put stuff in there that you can't taste and you don't know what's in there. Okay, like fluoride, like lead, these other things. You didn't know about the lead in Flint, Michigan until it had gone on quite some time. And your kids are exhibiting very severe symptoms.
Acting
crazy. What's the matter with them?
Yeah. Fluoride turns you in to a violent person. Mm-hmm. And they've done studies on this. This is no, and fluoride has the same effects that lead does in a person. So there you go. It's neurological. They've done studies on that out of Harvard. David, thanks for joining us. We're going to bring in Joe Biggs, but let me tell you something, people. You are crazy if you're not getting prepared with storable food and water and some of the nutraceuticals we have, especially the iodine. You know, you have to get prepared. Now, I want to bring Joe Biggs in here to talk about this story here. So go to InfoWarsStore.com, by the way. We have also a 10% off Survival Shield. Act now for a limited time only. And 30 to 40% off of the storable food. You're crazy if you don't get in on that deal. This is Fox News Latino. Oakland, California police cancel Cinco de Mayo DUI checkpoints after outcry. So, hey, guess what that means? Go out and get drunk in Oakland. It's okay. There, nobody's going to be checking you. There's no, and I'm against DUI checkpoints, especially the blood draws where they do this. But then saying, we're not going to even put them up now because this is a Hispanic holiday, even though they don't even really celebrate it in Mexico. This is sort of like an American Corona holiday.
Fiesta time and jail, or what is it, fiesta time or jail times? And that was so offensive to all these people out there in Oakland where they got on their Facebook pages and they band together to make sure that this didn't happen because it's horrible to stop these guys from getting smashed on tequila all day and going out and then driving and running over some innocent bystanding family walking down the street.
But they're not stopping the NSA. They're not stopping the TSA.
They're not stopping the white folks from drinking on St. Patrick's Day or the 4th of July because you know, that's okay. But we can't offend, you know, everyone out there with piñatas and sombreros on. You know, we're going to that's horrible.
The decision to cancel the checkpoints came after a backlash on social media. So there it is right there. If you get mad and you can perceive, if you could just say it's racist, like Rob Reiner. I got a clip from Rob Reiner. We're going to play this one real quick. You know, they're saying, hey, they're asking, what do you think about all the Trump supporters? He goes, well, they're all racist. Well, he didn't say they're all racist. He's like, there's a lot of racists out there. And so apparently anybody who is a Trump supporter.
And there's no racist Bernie Sanders supporters.
Exactly.
Hillary Clinton supporters.
No, when they hang Trump's head on a pole and beat it with giant sticks, that's an act of love.
When someone screams, that's you're effing white and spits at you, I'm pretty sure that's pretty much racist.
There you go. Let's play that Rob Reiner clip.
That is true, but how do you explain the millions and millions of people who do not watch this show, who actually like what they hear from Donald Trump and aren't taking messages and orders from us in the media, but they listen to what he says for themselves and vote for him? How do you explain that?
Well, there are a lot of people who are racist.
Oh, my
racist.
God.
Did you just say that?
I'm not saying.
No,
I'm
you just said that.
Well, that's true.
So you think that people saying, that vote for Donald Trump are
they're
racist?
They're not all racist.
You led with that, though.
No, I said
they're not all. There's like two or three that aren't racist, you know, but all the rest of them are. You know, I've gone and talked to these people. These are just normal, hardworking Americans of all races, colors, and creeds, and they just want to have the ability to provide for their families and not be taxed to death and not be forced to buy Obamacare.
And they want the ability to go and listen to a presidential candidate speak.
Yeah.
And maybe a lot of these people are undecided. Maybe some of them are on the fence about maybe Bernie Sanders or something. Maybe they want this chance to finally go listen to Trump and hear what he has to say. And instead, what happens is they're spit on. They're called racist. Their children have to go through that as they're walking in and out of these events. It's completely ridiculous.
Yeah.
So that's why we are going to Eugene, Oregon tomorrow.
That's right. Hey, let's show some of the love from SoCal. This is some of the love that they exhibited while we were in Southern California. They were all very, you know, all carrying their posters of love. There's a guy, that guy's car later got spray painted. And yeah, there's some nice people there. This guy's wearing a Hitler, Stalin, and Mao gun, mass murders agree, gun control works. There, they show some love to the police car right there. You can see the broken windows. Yeah, and then, oh, there's the guy jumping on the car.
The best part is when he slides and falls, he has to limp off because he hurts himself.
Well, then there's a Trump supporter they beat up just because he had a Trump shirt on. They took his hat and then pretty much knocked him around, threw him on the ground, started punching him, you know, and he's just a blogger. And I posted that up on Twitter, these pictures, because they were so outlandish. And I called the guys thugs who beat him up. And I was like, why are you calling them thugs? What else do you call somebody who beats up another person for wearing a shirt?
Yeah, the guy's walking out of an event trying to get back to his vehicle.
He was in his car trying to leave. They had it blocked off, and he got out to see what was going on because he's a blogger, and they take his hat. And he's, give me my hat back. No, boom, boom. That's what thugs do. Sorry. Thugs attack people like that. So you guys are going to be out in Eugene, Oregon. They've already got, I put the Facebook link up there. They've already got about 600 people that say they're going to be there protesting Donald Trump. And, you know, they put the talking points. He's a racist, misogynist,
yeah, so
sexist.
Tomorrow's event's going to be at the Elaine Events Convention Center in Eugene. And the doors open at 4. The actual rally starts at 7. The counter protest, which will be held the same area, will be at 5 p.m. is what they're saying. But so I'm sure, though, it'll be around 4. And
what they're going to do, what you're going to see is, and this is exactly how it happened in Southern California, it'll be nothing for a while. You get there and go, wow, there's no protesters. And then there may be a couple in there walking around talking to people. And then they're all going to march in all at once. Yeah, and they're going to have their signs ready to go. And if the cops are there, they might get in between them. They might not. If they don't, who knows what could happen? Because they did it, and they got in between them in Southern California with the war horses that they were riding. And that kept things peaceful, at least to a physical degree. They weren't getting, but they were getting verbal with each other. Then they all went out and blocked the road for people exiting. So you got thousands of people that couldn't get in. They're not going to hang out there all night, so they all start to leave. And that's when you're going to see, I think, the fireworks go off. And these people aren't peaceful, and they don't have love in their hearts. They hate anything that is not socialist and collective.
And the funniest thing is that one of their biggest chants is stop the hate in our state, and yet they're the ones that are the most hateful, vile, nasty, disgusting, ridiculous excuses of human beings. I mean, they're
just using it as an excuse to go crazy. They really are. So we'll see how it happens in Eugene. We're gonna be out there watching you. We got Darren McBreen going with
special guest Joe McBreen.
Yeah. So McBreen doesn't go on a lot of these missions.
Last time you went out with us was the Spokane, Washington trip.
That was where the sheriff
Ozzie Nezevich.
Yeah.
They had that video of that sheriff sitting there saying that these MRAPs were going to be used for constitutionalists and all that, and it really pissed off a lot of people around the country and within Spokane. And we all went out there and you know, rallied with these people. And
we have another cop on video saying there's IEDs being made. And here we have, he might be right. Look, here's extremely dangerous IED found under Texas bridge. So the McLennan County Sheriff's Office and Bob Squad used a water cannon to breach a suspicious device found under a bridge Tuesday night.
Yeah, that was in Rosebud up near Temple.
Exactly. So how is this getting made? Do you think this was made by domestic hands, or could it be our intrusive little Al-Qaeda ISIS operatives that we know or have made it all the way up to Dallas because they tried to shoot people up there at a Draw Muhammad cartoon rally?
I mean, we already have these reports from Judicial Watch. These guys are already in an opera. I went down there a year ago from the 15th of April, I believe. So, yeah, I went down there and actually went into an opera, looked around, FBI talked to me afterwards, and now we have confirmed reports of these ISIS guys down there training, ready to come in, and now we have these IEDs found. I mean, that's why Trump says we need to secure the border. That's why we need it.
And here it is today out of the Daily Mail. Illegal immigrant numbers spike at the Mexican border as surge in new arrivals grows after Trump's vow to seal off the southern border. And border guards have seen a 78% jump in unaccompanied children. So people are just sending their children up there to fend for themselves.
Well, the best.
They're working with these drug cartels and the coyote networks.
Well, the funniest thing was how Vicente Fox.
And he's apologized.
Yeah, he comes out and apologizes yesterday. Yeah. And then Trump comes back and answers with, "You're going to be spending all this money to build this." That's why, I mean, you got to love that guy. I mean, that's just hilarious.
He's telling it like it is. Let's go to a couple callers now. We got Hector in Texas. Wants to know, audit the Fed, did it secretly happen? Hector, what kind of news do you have on audit the Fed?
Yeah, actually, I'm really coming to you guys to see if you can use your, you know, journalism skills to validate this story or not. Josh Tolley's show is also on the GSN network yesterday, had a guy speaking about that the audit the Fed really did happen secretly, and that they may have found up to $800 trillion worth of hidden gold, and that General Dunford has even used the special forces to close the Fed on the East Coast and reset up shop in Salt Lake City, and that they're secretly creating federal greenbacks that are non-interest-bearing to the American people and that will actually be backed by gold.
Well, maybe that's why the secret meeting happened between Obama and Yellen. You know, we don't know what happened because they're keeping it secret, because that's the way this administration has been, definitely behind closed doors. We'll be right back with more of your calls, finishing up the last segment of the fourth hour. Well, I was searching for audit the Fed. Did it really happen? And I didn't find anything on that on Google, but I'm going to do some more searches after this show and see what I could find. But I did run across this from Politico. Trump doubles down on deportation. Says, yes, absolutely, they're going to be deported. Look, we either have a country or we don't. We have many illegals in this country. We have to get them out and go through the process, go through a system. And the ones that have done well and really achieved, we want to bring them back. And now some economists believe doing this, especially in a single year, would dramatically reduce the GDP and send the U.S. into recession, possibly depression. This could be because many of the jobs done by immigrants in restaurants, hotels would go unfilled. I don't know if I believe that. I worked as a cook and a dish dog in a restaurant for a couple of years while I was in college.
I mean,
and I delivered pizzas. I mean, I've done pretty much every low-level job you could do to make a little money while I was bettering myself and learning skills.
I mean, I washed dishes at a Hooters and worked my way up to the fry guy.
I think there's plenty of people that are going to fill jobs.
But here's the thing, though. Look, deport illegals, employee veterans. We've got a lot of homeless veterans right now. And Austin alone, laying under bridges, sleeping outside. They have nothing. They're trying to make some kind of money on the side, standing on corners. These guys need jobs. And they're sitting there saying, they hold up signs, "Hey, looking for work. I need something." Get rid of these guys that don't need to be here, that don't want to sneak in the back door, don't want to come through the proper process. Give these veterans who've already served their country a job and a chance to make something, and let their country see them, try to work for them as they did for their country. We need to help these veterans out before we go and sit here and go, "Well, no, these are only for these guys." No, we still got enough jobs here to help these guys out. Let's take care of our own people first.
I agree. And then you have what's going on with, here's an article here from USA Today. 51% of immigrant-led households receive at least one kind of welfare. I believe if you're going to come here illegally, you shouldn't get welfare. You shouldn't be able to get it. You shouldn't even remotely qualify for it. I don't think you should be able to get a license. If I go to Mexico and say I have a gun in my trunk of my car, well, they're going to put me in jail for what, 14 months? How long was the Marine in jail for?
Yeah, Andrew Tomorsi was in there for about a year and a half almost. It seemed like, I mean, he was there for a long time. Went through depression, starvation.
For just taking a wrong turn. Okay. He wasn't even trying to immigrate illegally into Mexico. He just took a wrong turn. And here we're like, hey, let's open it up and give everybody welfare. And, you know, and I know people are going to come back, more whites are on welfare. I know. I think welfare should be set up as a way to get you to into a better place, not as a place where you're going to sit and be on welfare for the rest of your life.
It's just like with those McDonald's jobs. Yeah, they're $8 an hour or whatever it is. It's not a job for you to stay and take care of your family. Yeah, there's going to be some instances where some people just don't have anything else but that. But that's a small percentage, like the 0.03% of transgendered Americans who want to be able to go use the men's bathroom or the women's bathroom that aren't that sex. Sorry, we have more people. We need to focus on the masses, the people who are here. We don't need to worry about the 2 or 3 freaking, thousand people who are all of a sudden offended by this because they can't do that. Get a job, move on from McDonald's, go on to something else, strive for better. That's what America is all about. The pursuit of happiness, not the promise or the guarantee, but the pursuit, the try to do better and continue to move forward.
And you could go into almost any library, get on YouTube and learn new skills. There's no excuse for you. I can't learn it. I can't go to school. I can't afford it. There are plenty of skills out there that you can learn and better your life with. We're going to end with Dustin here in Tennessee. He wants to talk about Trump in Tennessee, racism, and he's got a local update on a story. Dustin, go ahead.
Guys, what's going on? Nice to finally get through and speak with you guys. Just real quick, I was down and I live in the Knoxville side, which is far east or whatever, and I was doing some work down in Memphis, which is, as you guys know, I'm sure you've seen on TV, pretty poor part of the state. But anyway, I was driving my car. I had my Hillary for Prison sticker on, my Trump t-shirt, and I was right in the middle of the hood, and I came across one house that had a Trump. It just happened to be the house I was going to for work. Anyway, I got out, started talking to the people, and they came in and was like, why would you bring your racist butt in here? And we started talking about, why am I racist because I like Trump? And a lot of people are so ignorant. They're just so unlearned. They don't understand really what
Trump
stands
for. And that's why we have to learn them. We have to talk to more people, and that's the only way things are going to change. So thanks for joining us on the fourth hour of Overdrive. I'm your host, Rob Dew. Infowars.com.